on the agenda is to approve the agenda. Is there anything that needs to be amended to this evening's agenda? Or are we good to?
Yeah, Chris, I'd like to add an agenda item somewhere. What I wanted to do is give you folks an update on the emergency shelter container. Research that I've been doing.
You want to do it under other business or have it be run under the draft budget stuff?
Thank you. Oh, yeah, that's perfect. Thank you.
You want it before the town? Not before
the
Teresa's?
Budget?
Before Teresa's report there?
Yeah, that's fine.
So we'll put it at the bottom of the agenda items before the town manager's report. I'm going to put it just below where it says draft FY 2022-2023 budget discussion. So that will be the emergency shelter discussion. Anybody have any issue with that? We'll be making any decision about this.
Shall the voters adopt all budget articles by Australian ballot? And then 14, shall the voters authorize cannabis retailers? So the select board, obviously you can decide what you want to do for, say, Australian ballot. Do you, you know, there's options. With Australian ballot, is not one and done. Australian ballot is, you can put on the warning, so we will discuss it at the town meeting in March that we hold in person. And people will vote in person whether this moves on and is in effect in the following town meeting. So when you move to vote Australian ballot, you could vote just officers, which means town clerk, treasurer, select board, lister, you know, those sorts of things. If you, the other thing you can do is you could also have your budget voted Australian ballot, and other public questions can also be voted Australian ballot. The select board has had this conversation with a mix of people present, and it seemed like the common theme was people, if they were getting a vibe, maybe having representation, because it's difficult to vote the budget Australian ballot, because you can't have that discussion that you have at town meeting. If somebody wants to change an article, you can't. You know, someone would have to vote the entire budget down because it's a budget discussion, but the ballot obviously is already printed. So the select board can decide what they want to put on the warning. However, the select board has been listening to people who said they wanted to maybe vote the officer's Australian ballot. So if the select board doesn't choose to put it on the warning, someone could pass a petition to do so. So the select board's trying to get a lot of public input to make an informed decision. So maybe that isn't necessary. The other question on here is about cannabis. Originally, when the first act, whatever, that came into play, it said that towns had to vote on cannabis retail operations by this town meeting, March 2022, or we would automatically be opted in. Then they changed that. Act, I forget the number, came in and said, we're not going to make you an automatic opt-in town. You're going to leave it up to the towns to vote cannabis retailers in or out. And there's no deadline for that. So we don't actually have to vote that at this town meeting. What would have to happen, however, is if someone wanted to have a cannabis retail operation in Bethel, they would have to come to the select board, and the select board would have to do a, you know, a town vote. We would have to vote it. Whether they would close the town meeting and we could wait, or it was early and the select board wanted to do a special election, whatever. But either way, it's still, that's a yes or no that has to come from the voters. So those are the unusual things that are on town meeting, or on possibly to go on the morning. And but no decision had been made. We tried to publicize it more to get a little more input. I know select board members have been talking to people. Chris and I went and had to breakfast one morning with a group of people at a sandwich shop that meet there on a regular basis, trying to get, you know, different people's feelings about it. So,
thanks,
so that's where we're at.
Not saying I'm in favor or against it, but when I was looking at this a little more thoroughly, trying to figure out how that would coincide with the meeting itself. So let's say we did the option of, or say we went to vote the option of officers as
the Australian
ballot, but we were going to hold the budget in person. How would that meeting look like? And to vote, so I'd circle, like, I think that you'd still have to have the town moderator, town clerk, and treasurer be done from the floor. Because you can't have the town moderator be voted on.
You can.
You've got to have the meeting that day.
He would still be, he's in office until the vote. So basically what happens is when he's voted in, it's until the next vote. So even if you, like if say, just for example, Rick Benson gets reelected this town meeting in person, he stays, he's the moderator of the next meeting.
So he'd just be running
the
back end of the meeting rather than the front end of the meeting?
Right, he's still the moderator.
Because I was just wondering, like, there might be some of those pieces that, I mean, it's not to say, I mean, it only takes a couple of seconds to, you know, usually the
bill will be able to vote it out.
Exactly.
But,
I mean,
exactly.
Would that be something that you just do?
I don't know if you can. I have to read the statute.
No, you can't pick and choose?
I don't think so. I think that the vote is exactly the way I put it. I think it has to be, shall the voters elect its town officers by Australian ballot pursuant to that statute? I don't think you have an option. So what happens is your person is still the moderator and until Paul's right to lose voted out. So, but how it, you're right, it looks funny because I think you would have your budget discussion. Basically, haven't you done that in the past? I guess that's my question. Would you, if you're voting the budget, if the say you were voting, if you're doing your same town meeting during the day, you would just have an election going on at the same time.
Right, going on.
For your officers. So your current select board is still your select board until they're not.
So does that include listeners and trustee public?
Yes. Yep. And you don't do library trustees. So, yeah, and I think we've, now there's no more, there's no more grandeur or.
I mean, the information that I have collected right now,
there's no more grandeur.
From people that I've talked to is, like, Australian ballot with the budget and the cannabis thing has not been popular.
Yes. You mean Australian ballot?
Australian ballot for the budget.
Has not been, but, okay.
Yeah, and the cannabis piece hasn't been favorable.
No.
Amongst people I've talked to. And I would say, you know, somewhere maybe close to 50%, mm-hmm. kind of on the, you know, if we get the officers in person or not. Seems to be the information that I've collected, and I don't know if you all have, you know, talked to anybody else and what yours.
I mean, I've been talking to more folks in my age group, and they would like to see from the floor for everything. And the cannabis thing, they just didn't see the sense of even starting to talk about that until we had to.
Yeah, we had a couple of people that were, in older than me, And they were just said, and they said,
be careful.
That's all, that's not bad. I'm just saying, and they, a couple of people were very vocally opposed to cannabis, saying we're so close to the interstate, they didn't want people just getting off the interstate then, you know, buying cannabis, getting back on and not really spending any time here. So that, but that was just a couple of people that I heard from. But
what about you, Gene? What has been your
conversations that I've had?
Largely with the Equity and Inclusion Committee folk, the Bethel Black Lives Matter folk, and they tend to favor voting for officers, Australian, because it's more accessible to a wider number of, so those who go to town meeting can vote, but so can those who don't. And it's, and if we're hearing, you know, half 50-50, then I think putting it on a ballot makes
so
a lot of sense.
Or
putting it on the warning, and then have the town, let's talk about it, let's debate it.
So you've heard some favorability for the officer piece. What about the budget itself?
I've also heard great appreciation for town meeting.
Okay.
For the whole idea of the democratic idea of people getting to get in, and you know, I want to share that.
And what about the cannabis piece?
If we just put the officers on, the cannabis piece would be an in-person meeting.
So we do the cannabis.
Oh, you're saying.
Because if we the way this is written, if all we put on was item 12, that elect the town officers by Australian ballot. That leaves everything else to be done from the floor of the town meeting.
If we even put it on the warning.
It were even on the warning.
Yeah, right.
So whether it's cannabis or a non-binding or whatever, if it's not an election of an officer, it goes on the warning.
But are you in favor of
putting
it on the
warning?
Like, it sounds like, from what information I've collected, what Paul's collected, that people would rather just not deal with it unless somebody petitions for it, let's say.
You're talking about cannabis.
Cannabis, yeah.
Oh, cannabis?
Yeah. I was just trying to go through the all three of them to see what everybody's information.
I'm mixed on that. I did hear a rumor or whatever that there may be a wholesaler, a person looking at growing it, which is not retail.
That's beyond our purview. Yeah, the state.
But it's not retail.
Right.
But it's also telling me it's not going to not happen.
Right. The thing
is, at some point, we're going to have to.
Well, cultivation, yeah, whether he was going to sell to someone else or what he's going to do, right.
State.
And that's a state issue. We have currently.
Well, we don't have any
law.
Power over
that. No, we don't.
Passing the bill would be perfect for propagation. So seriously,
there have been a number of people that have suggested that to me.
Yeah, cultivation is covered by the state, not the municipality.
Part of me says we're going to have to face it at some point. And whether you agree with it or I agree with it or oppose it is beside the point. At some point, the town's going to have to do it. Do we want to have to decide to do it with a special election, which costs funds that we don't have?
It doesn't necessarily have to be a special election. I mean, someone could come to us in June and say, something, and we can say, well, we're going to put on the warning for March, you know.
I don't think there's currently a deadline on when. I'd have to reread the statute.
But remember, as soon as we vote on it, so if you did
vote positively for it, at that point, and somebody came in, they would be grandfathered at that point. So whatever regulations get passed down the road, it wouldn't matter at that point. So
right, if you
stuck
voted,
with
or
so even if you turned around and voted no for it the next year,
then
anybody that might have been in
vice versa.
It's written in that what they passed down to us. Once you let them in, they are in.
That's what the person said.
Right, but I'm saying
you can't vote no.
Well, you can.
If you vote yes, you can't vote no.
You can vote no, but the people then grandfather
yeah.
So we voted yes, and one person came in to sell retail.
Do you want me to go get it?
And let's say the next year we have an overpouring amount of citizens that said, we don't want this, put it back on the warning, and we vote no. We would become a no town, but the person that has the storefront is that grandfather. Right?
Yes.
I mean, that's the way I
said. That's why I agree with you.
So, I mean.
So, but vice versa, if we were to have it on the warrant for this meeting and the town voted no, then we voted no.
What about you, Dave? Whatever you
want. I think you can figure out what I'm on the scale of 14.
14 cannabis
no.
One, so.
I see that one here.
Okay. And then what about the Australian ballot pieces?
I haven't really talked to people, but I personally, I do not want to get rid of the town meeting. It's a very important part of our of Vermont, of Bethel, the whole thing about somebody said they had to be jerks who came over and without coming to the meeting, this is what I'm going to have to say. I think that because I've heard that in the past, don't vote for this person because he's a good jerk.
Well, he used to.
and that's okay, but if they come to the meeting and vote,
that's
okay.
So, well, the audience-wise, well, why don't I just take a poll to see hands of yay or nay on it.
I have a comment, Chris.
Yeah.
Laura Perez, Bethel resident, and my comment is in regards to the Australian ballot for voting and, you know, for the budget as well as the positions in town. But just from an equity perspective, I think it's worthwhile having it on the morning for conversation. That for equity, from the equity perspective, I think it's a worthwhile topic to keep on the morning. While there will always be people who are unable to take the full day off to come and be part of the conversation, I think it's worth having. And so I'm in strong favor of having it on the morning.
Well, just remember, in Vermont, everybody's allowed to take the day off. It doesn't have to be paid, but they're allowed to.
And that's true, but the reality for many people in a blue-collar, working-class town is that they may not be able to afford to take the day off.
So if we pooled, if I just pooled the, like, maybe a show of hands. I mean, we did this at the last one, too. I think there was a whopping 3 people at the last meeting, so our sample population is usually pretty small. But if we went to a show of hands, I mean, is there in favor of Australian ballot by town officers? And
can I?
So this would just be like we would vote for the officers by town question. Yep.
I just want to understand completely that the Australian ballot is something where if you are not here, you can still vote. Is that what
you're
saying? Yeah,
Australian ballot would be just like presidential election.
Like an absent ballot.
You would go.
Yes.
Yeah, you'd go between 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. to the polls and you'd be able to vote.
You wouldn't necessarily have to be to the town meeting.
Or
mail in. Yeah.
You could do an absentee ballot.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay.
But you're right. That's
yeah, if you request it. Yeah. Correct.
It takes, why do you ask really? If you don't want to go to vote, you just ask for
I agree in a lot of ways that we should be having
the people who come to the meetings are the people who can take the time or are committed to coming. And that is a slice of the population. And so if we're representing people in our town, then Australian ballot is a really democratic way to do it. So it isn't meaning, I wouldn't support Australian ballot as a supplement or I would only accept it as a supplement to a town meeting. I think the town meeting is absolutely necessary and people should be coming, but it isn't just about voting, it's about a discussion. So, and I think it's got to be a blending somehow.
But understand that you can't have both an Australian ballot and a town meeting from the floor vote for, say, an office.
Yeah.
It's one or the other.
No, it isn't. It's just that right now it's only being presented as one or the other.
No, you can't. If you have people who have signed petitions and so on and so forth to be placed on the ballot, that ballot is printed and it's hard and fast. It can't be amended at the town meeting by having another person nominated.
Right. It's the accessibility of the voting process that I'm talking about.
It's a complicated solution,
but you can't just say, in this climate of necessarily being more inclusive, you can't just say, the only people that are going to vote on this are the people who can make it to the meeting at 10 o'clock on Tuesday morning. It doesn't make sense any longer. But at the same time, you can't give up, I don't think we can give up the meeting at 10 o'clock. So I'm not solving it for you. Saying my preference is both.
I understand, and that's, I think, is why the conversation has divided election of officers from financial budget and other business.
Yeah.
One to happen at a in person for those.
Seems to me from the polling that we've done around the state that, well, most of it is two ways. It's either full Australian ballot and no town meeting day activities, which seems to be most prevalent in the state of Vermont, especially in the higher populated areas. And then the other one is some of the hybrid methods like you had talked about, where they may vote. It seemed like the most prevalent one on that one was they vote for the officers through the Australian ballot system, and then they do the financial piece in what they call the town meeting setting. So you kind of blend both of those. And then there are very, very few towns in Vermont that still do everything from the floor. So, and I guess a piece of what we've talked about the board here is if it's old or not, it's still a tradition of the town, and there's not many towns that still vote everything from the floor, It's like everybody has a landline at home for telephone, so it's those types of things, but it's a bit of a historic piece of the town.
Inclusion and all that, yeah. I chose not to. And nobody else. So there's nobody elected. Then, the other four of you that are still not get to choose to be elected. So now the inclusion that you're all open or worried about isn't going to happen. Because you're going to have four people that are going to decide who your next selectman is. That's going to happen in the school this year.
Nobody wants to lose the overall seemingly comment that we reached. Nobody wants to lose the community of town meeting and having people get together and have great discussions and pie. People were very adamant about they wanted pie, and so we've had a lot of feedback. So it's been interesting, but. And we had spoke to, Jesse Potsky, remember he was here one night representing the Equity and Inclusion Committee, and Jesse said he thought, Australian ballot officers, but, you know, maybe not the budgets. Because we have, you know, but we've been talking about it at each, you know, meeting a little bit. So, and then, of course, there was the cannabis issue, so.
Well, I think it makes sense not to do the budget unless you have a ballot.
Then it's just yes or no. As opposed to having it at a town meeting where you can discuss and change. Like a few years ago, we changed the rec money for the skateboard park. It was changed at the town meeting. So that makes, I think that makes all the sense to have the budget done from the floor.
However, I mean, nothing's easy because it's, you know, it's just like we found out, I don't know, 6, 7 years ago when I first got on the board that town meeting was very confusing because somebody got up on town, you know, off from the floor that changed the budget and half the people there didn't even understand what they were voting for. They voted for it and then we had to find $54,000 to take out the budget. You know, and nobody, and that wasn't the intent, but then it went through, you know, so it's, and I guess if you had Australian ballot for your budget, it's yes or no, right? I mean, there's no maybe or if or change this, so, I mean, I guess there's a silver lining for all of it.
You know, any citizen of Bethel can come to any one of these meetings planning for the budget leading up to town meeting and have an opportunity to lend voice and opinion to the development of the budget, and it does not all have to happen on one day. You see, there, like Chris was saying, I mean, there's a lot of opportunity for input leading up to town meeting. Mm-hmm. And I really stand in favor of at least having the discussion at town meeting.
And that's the benefit of it too. It goes on the morning, or you decide whether or not it goes on the morning, and then whoever's at the present town meeting is going to vote up or down anyways. So.
I mean, on the budget end of things, I mean, we've, you know, last year obviously we did everything from pressure the ballot because of COVID. Most of the time it is from the floor. And we always have an informational night or two for the budget in person before that. And I would say last year we had just as many people that showed up on the, you know, on the COVID year as we did the previous years, which is 3 or 4 people, you know. So you're only getting a sample population of 3 or 4 people out of 2,000 that are voicing their opinion, where budget in person, at least, there's usually on average 200 people, you know, that are there, so at least at present, and often they have a question or something, but, so.
But we don't have to decide which is the better choice. We have to decide whether to put it on.
Right, and we want to put it on the warning, you know, because right now it's either the select board can put an item or 2 or 3 on the warning to vote on town meeting. This doesn't mean that this town meeting would change because, you know, unless it's voted from the floor, we will continue to be an in-person voting town meeting day. So nothing would change in March. This would be if we decided to put one of these questions on there and it did, you know, was successful, then, you know, the 2023 town meeting day would change slightly or whatever it would be.
Well, it would change. This is so. Adopt all budget articles, but you're actually not saying anything about offices. You're talking about putting the entire town meeting on Australian ballot.
Well, if you look at, we did it separately. I looked at VLCT's morning, so 12 is Australian ballot for officers.
Yeah, it's for both of them is what I'm saying. That you're putting the entire, you're giving, if this is the warning,
no,
you're giving the voters a chance to say yes to Australian ballot on both issues.
Yeah, this, if that's what the dislike.
And that in 2023 would be just like that, one more town meeting.
I know, and that's why they're.
And that's what I'm saying, is that you can't be worried like this if you want to have an opportunity to blend them.
I don't think there's any intention currently to have to go up like this.
This is just a
I think the intention is just for us to have a talking point.
Oh.
These are the options that we could put in.
Yeah, this is.
Do we want to, you know, because we could just say we're not doing any of them.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
And then somebody can petition.
There's beneficial aspects of Australian ballot, is what I'm saying.
Sure.
If you word your warning so that it opens up the possibility for Australian ballot to be part of the town meeting annual process, then that can be a yes or no, and it doesn't need to change everything instantaneously overnight. But if you pass it like this, it's like there goes town meeting in one vote.
Yeah, I took this right from VLCT's draft warning selection because we had this conversation, obviously, that was always voted from the floor. So this was when I got my language from them because they said we would do it in three questions. We'd either do Australian ballot, the budget, public articles. So their suggestion was we vote in three. So we've just been having this discussion because it was brought to the select board so that to see, and some people want the officers Australian ballot and some people don't want anything Australian, you know, so it's been this kind of mixed
bag. Well, there's a real dichotomy in the way people look at governance. And
yes.
A lot of people could possibly just say, yeah, we want Australian ballot because it's more inclusive and it's all these things, and it is. But that doesn't mean that they understand anything about town meeting or town budgeting or town government. So you can't, I don't think you can use these examples like this.
So I would suggest that I'm just going to throw this out there, leave 12, eliminate 13, and eliminate 14.
Right, and I think that's what we talked about last meeting. That was probably the most feasible approach that we've heard to date. So this is what they 13.
So what that means for folk out there is that the only thing about town meeting we would vote on would be whether or not to elect officers by Australian ballot. Everything else would continue. That if we eliminated and it would be, in my opinion, less confusing to the people at the town meeting about what it was we were actually saying.
The budget.
I'm just curious. You're going to have it in here.
It's right there, 14.
Seems like the discussion is about making voting more accessible to more people. So if you word it like this, it's just like, you either take the Australian ballot for town officers or you don't. I just wonder where the discussion is in the select board for expanding voting opportunity at town meeting beyond this.
So give us an example.
So obviously, this is just a draft.
It doesn't matter.
Well, I guess I'm just trying to figure out because the way I see it is, or the way it is either you go to paper ballot to do your voting, or you vote in person.
Yeah. So what's the motivation for even considering Australian ballot this year?
The motivation is we've had people come to us who said they want the select board to consider voting Australian ballot because they did it last year. And now people are coming saying we want to vote Australian ballot now. They don't want to vote, have people come in person and vote for the officers. They want to be able to do it Australian ballot.
Why can't we do both, Tracy from River Road? Why can't we do both absentee and in-person voting?
I don't know if
absentee you can, not Australia. Two different things. Absentee ballot. When we count ballots, we count absentee after we do the other ballots.
You do, but you vote.
Solution is one of the issues that we raise.
Is the dog park or a dog walk, is that outdoor recreation?
I
know where I'm going.
Yeah, because you're talking about the boat wreck grant. I have no idea. I don't know. And right now, the rec center is an issue with people not cleaning up dog waste. So I don't, that's an issue there currently. But I don't know. I mean, you have, Fortitude, is that right one down here? But I don't know. I mean, also people could but it's hard. You could do a fence in there if someone clean it up. You'd have to look for volunteers and that sort of thing. So, but also to people, it's something that we could, toss out to the rec committee or something too and ask them about, but sidewalks, dog park infrastructure, just trying to take a moment. So yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure. That's a good question. You can bring it up when you have your in the vote rep meeting. I'm sure. I bet Rebecca would have a thought on that.
Well, thank you for bringing that to our attention. We'll make sure we'll at least have the discussions on what we can do better there on that. And so we'll have the discussions on what we can do to hopefully alleviate some of the issues
soon. Thanks.
As soon as possible.
I'll send a note to Oscar and Justin about some targeted enforcement. That's what we can do immediately. So I'll mention it to them. So when they're on.
But just go down under the under the bridge where you can park and walk down.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
sit there.
We're the ones that clean up under there all the time.
Yeah.
But if you just sit your car there and just for 10 minutes and watch everybody going back and forth.
But for now, we can ask the constables when they're on duty to maybe just look at Herb Street a little harder and pull a few people over just so people understand that there's activity going on there. So.
I can also reach out to Marcos Miller at the state and ask him about signs like that we have. What can he do on his end to get people on the state's end?
Yeah.
So.
Right, I'm sure we'll get
I don't know. I'll ask.
We'll see. So we're going to move on from the comment. And our first appointment discussion we had in regards to the Gilead, the end of the Gilead Road, the Class 3.
Could I maybe about 4 minutes before we start this discussion? Is that okay?
Yeah.
You guys got all my stuff in your packets, right? There's a ton of stuff.
Yes.
And I'm reading. Did you have a chance to read or?
Yes. He's Brian Wright, yes.
I'm Brian Wright, I'm sorry.
Yes. Everything.
I haven't met you, Mr. Krause.
Gene Krause.
Brian.
Yeah, everything went in the packet.
Okay.
You guys had a chance to read it. You read the letters from my daughter that. I gave you all this stuff, but I think it's really important you guys know what's going on and what's gone on for years and years and years up here. You got the letters from my daughters.
They got everything.
You got the letters, that the handwritten register letter I sent to my brother about the harassment.
Yes.
You got the registered letter for my lawyer that I hired. I just want you guys to know that. I had to write this down because I forget what I was going to say. Now I almost forgot to go around this. Rick and Beverly have created a very, very serious, volatile, and harassing, hostile situation that not only restricts me and my friends and family the free right to use the legal right of way in the town road and to enjoy our property that's up this town road past the farm, and also the general public who wishes to use the road. We had 15 witnesses in 2008 with my lawyer, and the list has grown to the ones that we know that have been bullied and harassed about the use of the road. Derek and Beverly have a huge control issue with everything. Everything up there, they got to be controlled. And it's going to stop now. I can go on for an hour about different stuff that's gone, and my kids can come in, I can get other people to come in. He's going to tell me, he's going to stand up and say that if none of it happened, but let him tell me. Anyway, we've got the witnesses. It's never going to stop. It's been gone. It's been going on since 1986 in our building camp. It slows down a bit when we receive the registered letters, but only for a short period of time. And I'm convinced that the only way that will stop them is a lawsuit where they suffer serious consequences for their illegal actions. Harassment, bullying, and being belligerent and aggressive behavior creating a hostile situation is illegal for people trying to use the town road. Now that I've brought this to the attention of the town, I think it's the town is obligated to stand by our side on this matter and provide legal counsel to bring this issue to an end that has been going on since I built the camp in 1986. I'd like the town to make an appointment for me to meet with the town council on this matter.
So
Thank you.
So, I was, well, other than documents that were in the packet, and, you know, we had talked a little bit about this last meeting, I was able to catch up with Therese up there today with the A&R gentleman, just to kind of walk through, and I got...
We should clarify that he was speaking about Wright Road.
Oh, Wright Road.
So he's talking, you're talking about Wright Road. We're talking about, yeah, so we're talking right now about Gilead.
And the reason I stopped, the legal issue was, number one, it got expensive. And number two, I'm hoping, well, maybe it's going to stop. It's not going to stop. It's never going to stop.
So I just wanted to stay on task with the, right now, the discussion is in regards to the Gilead Road and the stormwater issues, the classification of the road, and some of the condition and some of the work that we've done there. So I guess that's the piece that we're talking about right now. So, so for anybody that doesn't know, so the Gilead Road, we had, so I had done some work up there with the spring flood of 19, and, you know, Therese and I had assumed at that point that the class 3 ended at the house. You know, you get to the top of the road, and Gilead is the house, and then Gilead...
It's owned by Derek and Beverly that Andrew currently resides in.
And then,
the top.
And then from that residence forward, I had always assumed that that was a path or an ancient road type establishment. I didn't even think it was even class 4. So, to my surprise, that on our list is a segment of road that is listed as class 3 road, but not up to standard. And I took some pictures while I was up there today, just so you could get a little bit. I said it was like 4 o'clock, but I was up there like 3 with Therese. Just to give you a little understanding of what the road, if you haven't been there, what the road looks like. I mean, it's kind of a traditional...
So the pictures are the Gilead.
That's Gilead.
We're talking
about
Gilead first, okay.
Yep.
All
right. So right now, I would say if you went on a majority of class 4 roads in Bethel, that is probably an accurate representation of what a class 4 road looks. There's storm water that either flows down the road, or there's some water bars that are installed to move water from one side of the road to another. And there's limited culverts in place. You know, we don't do, maintenance to the road or plowing or type deal. So the current issues that we have, there's a bunch of issues up there, but the current issue we have up there is that some water bars have been installed without our class 4 permit piece. And the result of those water bars has moved storm water onto someone's property. So typically, if you have existing stormwater infrastructure, and that can mean a culvert, could mean acting water bars that you have permission from the landowners, we can maintain those at any time. So we can put it in a culvert, we can re-ditch the water bar. But if any new, so if all of a sudden you decided you wanted to put in a new water bar, you'd have to get permission. Evidently, what's happened on that piece of road right now is that an individual has gone out and done some excavation and installed some water bars, and that storm water is now going on to another individual's property. So at the last board meeting, we had talked about, because the work was done, we'll call it illegally or without permission, that we, the town, would go back and show those. And then we would look, working with A&R and the state, we'd look towards a long-term solution on bringing the road up to standards or reducing it to a class 4 roadway, those types of things.
Right, because we also had received, the person who was receiving the water on their property had also contacted A&R. So there was an investigation. So we received an email from the investigator for the enforcement officer, Dan Mason. So yes, the select board had said at the last meeting, didn't have the road crew go in and grade those out. And I said, well, we reached out to A&R and said, okay, what's the correct answer here? How do we deal with, you know, this road? Can you walk it with us and give us some advice on what the road, you know, how to deal with it? So we did walk today with a gentleman from A&R. And he did go through and we looked at some culverts that we had, that the town, you know.
There's like two or three culverts up there.
Or, no, well, there's culverts there. We don't know.
The town has a culvert.
Okay.
Somebody put it in.
There's three active culverts that are there from somebody.
Well, and do you know whether those people had authorization?
We don't know.
No, so I'm only bringing that up because the precedent that's been set up there, that people have been remanufacturing that road. You know, for years and years and years without the town. So it's complicated.
Well, yeah. And that's why I said there's a combination of a short-term solution and a long-term solution that we have to think about at the board. The short-term is, you know, the most recent work that has been done to the road that we had talked about, the last one was putting it back to where it was.
Yep.
And then the long-term solution is dealing with some of the stormwater. Well, there's some stormwater we can take care of now that we looked at today.
Talked about some ditching.
That's pretty simple that we can do. And then there's some long-term pieces, which is more, you know, what do we do there permanently? Like, you know, do we declassify it down to a class 4 and do some one-time upgrades on the road? You know, or do we upgrade it to class 3, which doesn't seem to be making, I don't know why it was ever class 3, because it's got boulders the size of this table in the road. But
when I was a kid, it wasn't that long ago. But road used to get graded. Webster and NFL used to grade it once a year. Believe it or not.
Well, we drove through there and maybe it's cars.
And it seems like if there's one individual has a home on the end of that road.
In Rochester.
That's in Rochester.
Yeah, that travels that every once in a while.
I think like a lot of these situations, it had to do with who was on the board at the time and whether or not they thought that that was a place that could be developed at some point, and they wanted to keep the classification of the road up there. Mm-hmm. So, so they didn't, that nuts or not up to standards classification allows for towns to have a road that's classified as class 3 but isn't maintained that way because there's no year-round no capacity for year-round maintenance. So it is class 3. So you wouldn't. So the question is, in that classification, how do you address? Albeit you're coming late to the party, but you've got unauthorized. You've got decades of unauthorized alteration of a class 3 road. And just because it's not at the standards, because your ordinances differ. Because I know, like right now, we're all like, well, it looks like a class 4 road. Everybody's using it like a class 4 road. So people should be able to alter the terrain, but it's actually not.
Right.
It's a class 3 road. And I know that, 5 years ago, one of our neighbors put up a speed bump on North Main Street because cars were going too fast, and that was a finable offense. Because it's a class 3 road at that point.
We do have a policy about it working in the towns right away. It's on the website. There's a permit. There's a process for people to go through, you know, to do, you know, work in the road. And certainly, so there is a process for it for class 3, you know, and we have a class 4 road policy, but there's still a highway access policy for curb cuts and stuff. So when we met with A&R today, there was some stuff that we could take care of ourselves, could go up and when you first access the road, you know, on the left past Andrews, you know, there's some ditch there that we could reestablish and get some water off the road and deal with that to make sure it's going into the culvert. And so we did get some good information from A&R, but you're right, the select board has to decide, you know, what are you gonna tear this road from class 3 to a class 4? You know, what's this, you know, there's some options.
The agency has instructed the towns in Vermont to do is we have to take care of 10 or 15% of the
Yes.
Not up to standard roads. We have to take care of, I think it's 10 or 15%.
Which we've been working on.
A year.
Because it's the new municipal road permit. And
right.
So you have to make sure.
We're bound that some of these roads that used to be this class three that's not up to standards, now we have to, you know, either start upgrading these or declassify them to be into the correct standards.
Right, yeah, that's a good point.
But
yes.
So there's some other issues up on that road too when we look today. I mean, there's some off-roading activities that are happening on there. There's a couple of spots where I would say jeeping or something's going on that's kind of ruined a couple of spots there.
Yeah.
It has damaged some of the ditching, you know, what little ditching there is on the side of the road.
Did I do it?
So there's some activity that's going on in the road that is, has a negative effect.
And we've talked about putting signs, you put signs up, but we don't have people up there policing them. So if the jeeps blow by the sign, they blow by the sign. It's,
So how is the ditch down by Andrews, if you can get in there, if it's not ledge, how is that going to help the 500 feet that's running down the road?
What we're saying was that was just one of the areas that we talked to that he gave us some advice on dealing with. We didn't say it was a whole road. I just said that was a piece of it that he had talked about when we looked at culverts, whoever installed those culverts. But right there, he was just saying to deal with some of the water that we have at the beginning of the road, his suggestion was that we go in and reestablish that ditch line ourselves. That was just one comment he made about a piece of the road.
Well, there was an end.
Did you cross that little water ground? My right away to the left was up across the field, right after the intercept. And just past that on the right, there was always a water ground that went down in the field for years and years and years and years. And I guess probably the road was washed down, or I think it might have some of it got filled in to go on in the field. Yeah, that was there for years, and that would take care of a lot of the water as well. That was put back in. But also, until you put a weight restriction on that road, you can do all the fixing you want. When he goes up there with his 40,000-50,000 pound manure spreader, that's the whole width of the road and the ditches, it's going to ruin him again anyway.
Well, I know that.
So you're
trying to decide what to do with the road, or are you trying to decide what to do about the issue of the current roadbed alteration?
So there was three things. So the first thing is the water quality. So there was an issue about potential water quality of the runoff. So that's why we got A&R involved. So A&R went out to look at it.
You also received the report from this class.
Yes.
So I'm just saying, because this discussion blows up quickly, so I would just, if you're talking right now about the alteration on that section of the road and how do you address it, I think that it doesn't necessarily have to do with where you make new ditches. You're talking about whether or not you fill in the water bars that were made.
And the Selectboard made a motion at the last meeting for the town to go in and do that, to remove the water bars. The Selectboard already made that motion at a prior meeting. And then we obviously have our own issues with, road crew timing, this and that. And then we decided we had a scheduled meeting with A&R because of the enforcement piece that came into play. Obviously, it was the fact that the road work that was done, that was under the guise that they thought we'd allow road work to be done, that was now damaging private property. We never allowed that road work to be done. So the Selectboard already made a motion at the last meeting to go in and take them out. We just met with A&R, so we wanted to see what we had for additional information tonight. So the Selectboard's motion still stands.
I guess what I was questioning was, if you're going to start talking about the remediation on this road, I want to draw your attention to our report.
It's in the past.
I'm just saying that there's no point getting too in the weeds about, in my mind, talking about where the ditches go on the Gilead Brook extension that you're talking about, because my report points out six other roads in the very vicinity, and which extrapolate to the entire town. And you're going to start chasing these water bars around if you don't have some more comprehensive viewpoint. So, yeah, there's a lot of solutions that we could come up with the Gilead section, mm-hmm. but are you understanding how that plays out into the rest of the town?
You're right. It becomes a bigger issue. I mean, they have plots for road policy, which you guys have looked at. What's your recommendation, Carl? I mean, do you feel like, not about this road in general, just in class four roads, you've seen the class four road policy, do you think that that's something that...
I think it's wholly inadequate. I think that the state has allowed the towns to acquiesce any responsibility to these roads, and both the Gilead Brook Road and the Wright Road exemplify the current conflicts on those roads, exemplify the problems that the state has allowed the town to create by allowing this no management issue of the fourth class roads. The roadbed, you talk about a roadbed. Well, there's no standard roadbed up there. Everything on these roads, many of these fourth class roads, haven't seen any town standard for probably ever, right? And so now you've got a town right-of-way in which we're trying to perpetuate public use, and the landowners are faced with having to deal with inadequate roadbed, water quality, and a whole lot of people driving off the side of the road into the ditch because it looks like it's a good pile of mud. So I think that the solution is that these roads need to be brought up to grade, or they need to be closed off. And I mean, I'm not saying you're going to be trucking material in all these roads, but they need to have roadbeds that can sustain the traffic that people are expecting to put on. And that has to do, it has a lot to do with water. It's water management. And you say stormwater, but it's not stormwater. This is groundwater.
Yep.
This is, we're building these roads. All of our logging operations, our forestry operations, in the woods, a woods road that's going to be used by a machine has to have more integrity than these fourth class roads do. So this is a big problem. And I don't think it's for the town of Bethel to deal with on its own. But I feel like...
Yeah, I mean, we had that road last year there where we had the failing
sewer. Then we had the... If I were going to do anything on Gilead Brook Road for a logging operation or something, I would put a ditch. I'd put water bars. I'd ditch that upper section so the water ran all the way back the other way to those culverts, and it'd be a deep ditch, mm-hmm. but it would bring the water back the other way, because unfortunately, or fortunately, whatever, the issue is that the neighbor does farm there, and the water in those access points is just going to lead to more erosion and more difficulty in the farm operation that doesn't need to be there, especially if you have equipment. But you have to start doing that on every single road that's like that in the town of Bethel.
Do you feel like there's a lot of issue? This is just my opinion, so I'm just asking the question. It seems like some of these roads that we've hung on to forever just go to someone's private property, so it's not like it connects from Bethel or Branchree or Brookfield or whatever to an existing road. So doesn't it create issues for landowners that have these roads, when in fact is some of these, again, it's my thought or opinion, some of these roads that we have that go to nowhere are just, I don't think that they should be class 3 or 4, because it's really just an easement, right? Just or a right of way to somebody's property, and it creates a hassle for them because all of a sudden a Jeep shows up. We have this issue on Spooner Road. These guys are pulling cars out. They keep going. And Hooper Hollow, we've had people get off from Camp Brook Road to go down Hooper Hollow to try to go over to go to Rochester. We're like, you just got off a perfectly good paved road to go somewhere. So, you know, do you feel some of these roads, do you think we just need to...
I think that economically the town is faced with needing to get rid of some of them, for sure. sure, because there's way too much remediation. And we walked on an entire road on our committee where the entire length of road is used regularly as if it were a class 4 road. Mm-hmm. And it's no longer. It was discontinued in 2007.
Yeah.
And people used two different private properties, private land. And most of the travelway isn't even anywhere close to what was the ancient survey.
Wow.
And that's regularly the landowners on both sides leave their roads open because people use them as if they're a fourth class road. And in fact, you can find those roads on maps, mm-hmm. Readily available online for backcountry recreation. So if we do it, if you did say, well, like, you know, like the upper section of Bayon Road,
yes.
It goes all the way up to the town line. And Rochester has no road on the other side. But everybody who drives that road goes on to Rochester. They drive right up over a stone wall and they go right into Rochester and they've made themselves a road. And it's been there for 30 years.
Wow.
So everybody believes it's there. So now we got to spend $10,000 on gravel or $10,000 on the road. So.
Right. So do you think that, so I know that the Class 4 Road Committee is looking at this, and obviously it's, you know, we have a lot of road. Is it something that the Class 4 Road Committee is hoping to make a recommendation at some point in the future to the Select Board to say, hey, look, we think that this road X, Y, and Z, you need to get rid of or discontinue? Should the Select Board expect some sort of recommendation at some point from the Class 4 Road Committee with some guidance to say, get rid of these?
I don't know. We've talked about it, but it seems very difficult because the criteria are amorphous. Because, you know, you can walk on these roads and you can say, well, it doesn't go anywhere. But you can solve that legally, what Therese is saying. You can grant the right of way to the person to get there. But the difficulty is trying to decide, you know, where the dollars balance. So it's not really, it's more of us trying to give the committee, give the Select Board information for you to decide whether or not to throw the roads up or not.
Right.
I think that's what it really comes down to. We're not professionally capable of going out and deciding whether or not what all the factors are that the Select Board should be.
Right, we're just going to have to start picking roads and going through the statutory process.
There are some roads that we walk on. We don't even know where the road is, really. There's no, you'd almost have to start with a survey to find the road first, because there's no road bed, there's no stone walls on either side.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, if someone would say, if you can show us roads that we can't find the road bed to, we should, then we'll discontinue all of those, then we can show you the roads. But, I mean, that it seems like that's really a decision for the Select Board to make, whether or not the roads are discontinued.
Well, no,
absolutely.
What's that?
Are you saying the Gilead Road doesn't go anywhere?
The Gilead Brook Road does go to a trail on the Rochester side.
And I had one time truck, I hauled wood up and down that road in the
70s. Yeah.
Yeah, well, that is a road, was a road, and it was a pretty good road.
No, but it's that the town of Rochester no longer recognizes rights of ways on some of the roads on the other side of our town line. So if there's a road that goes there and is being used by a Jeep road, it's not the Billy Brook Road I'm talking about. I'm talking about the Bayon Road. It comes up to a property line, there's a stone wall, and for 30 years people have been driving over that stone wall, and so it looks like a road. And that would be a road that should be thrown up.
Yeah.
So it sounds like we have, you know,
I think that all of these roads should be
It's true. I think what you're saying, right? I think we need to start looking at, frankly, I call it quadrants, just because when we did the April 2019 flood, we just divided the town in four. Right. And start looking at sections and saying, okay, because there's obviously a statutory process, and I understand it's a Select Board's decision. decision, they have to hold a hearing, and I know, and meet there's a process for it. I guess that's something that Select Board needs to start doing, is looking at sections of town and looking at these roads and saying, okay, what does it go to? Does it connect to an actual another town road? Are we dumping people out on private property in another town, so we're just creating this nightmare? What, I mean, what are we getting, you know, from the state for some of these roads, you know, for us to maintain? So, I think it's a good point.
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's what I tried to point out in this report.
And it was good.
You have significant barriers on all of these fourth class roads. It doesn't matter, like Rick is saying, yeah, we have plenty that started a benchmark somewhere that was oriented in 1823. And you can't find that benchmark now. So if somebody's gonna have a squabble about the center of the road right away, who's gonna solve that? That's the town of Bethel.
Exactly.
Holds that survey that shows where that is. Mm-hmm. How are you gonna prove it?
You're right, Carl. You're totally right.
And that doesn't matter whether somebody drives on it 15 drivers a Sunday or if they never go on it at all. It's the same thing is true. And the Charlie Wilson Road is a good example. It's a major, it's the snow machine trail all winter long. People drive on it all the time, and there were sections of that where there's easily 100 feet from one wheel rut to the other where the road has changed in there over the years, and it's a 50-foot wide trail.
Yeah, you're right, you've also
made
it.
So there's private land being impacted right there, right now.
Exactly.
And so the impact is being demonstrated, potential impact up on Gilly Brook Road with water being diverted into a private landowner's active field access is exactly the same thing as some Sunday driver deciding they're going to drive where it's easier to drive around a mud hole and they're on a private property. So it's just, they're ripe with these issues.
You're right, and I think you make an excellent
point. But how do you turn that around as the state is pumping money into backcountry recreation and they're counting on towns having these public rights of ways open for this? So this is not the town. So that's why I'm saying I don't think it's as simple as saying throw these roads up, because I think it's bigger than the town of Bethel. We have a statewide mandate to improve water quality across the state, and every single one of these towns has 25% of their road base, high elevation, no water quality control, no nothing. It's just a mud, you know, mud bath in wherever people want to go, impacting water quality, impacting public or private landowners. So my recommendation is that doesn't solve a particular issue for the roads that you're considering right now, but I think that we need to be expanding out to communicating with other towns to try to see what kind of resources we can get from the state to support this, because I think it's beyond volunteer
absolutely
work.
Yeah.
You know, this takes a lot of
a lot
of time to look at these issues specifically and to categorize each one of these roads. We found that there's a file folder in the town office for every one of these roads, and they're really comprehensive.
Mm-hmm.
They've just been sitting in there, and nobody knows what they are. But every single one of the folders has the survey. They've got all kinds of data. They've got several different iterations of the fourth class road committee have entered different information over the years in that. And so rather than us just redoing all of it, we just took on this section of the town.
Yeah, and I looked through there tonight too. But you're right, I mean, you know, I hadn't thought about the Carl, but you're right, there's a real, you know, kind of dichotomy between what's happening, you're right, they're pushing outdoor recreation, you're right, we're in the process of writing a $500,000 grant for trails, but you're right, at the same time, they're pushing this. They're saying you don't have to maintain class 4 roads. You want to do more outdoor recreation, but yet we're creating problems for people on their personal property. So you're right. This is an issue for everybody. It's not just Bethel. And so
that's why I think if the dollars are limited, you're going to have to pick and choose which roads you're going to put put this money into.
Well, and it is. I mean, we voted, you know, Selectboard, you know, we've been setting money aside in the capital road fund and divvying it up between roads, bridges, and class four roads. And, but yeah, it's pick a road, pick an area. How do you decide, you know, who's the higher?
We just started talking about it last year in regards to actually setting aside some money for fourth class roads, because we hadn't done that ever. We talked about that with Mo and whatnot.
Yeah.
Last year, starting to set aside a small amount, but $5,000 to $10,000, we can do a little bit here, a little bit there.
So how does that get us all back around to?
So in regards to the Gilead Road piece that we're talking about tonight, so up there with the A&R guy, his recommendations at this point was to fill in the water bars the way they were originally. Mm-hmm. I mean, yes, there's probably culverts and everything else that got put in by somebody that didn't have permission either, but we're just talking about the recent stuff.
Yeah.
He thought overall that, I mean, obviously, he said if it was a fourth-class road, he thought that it was in favorable condition for a fourth-class road with some minor upgrades. Obviously, for a third-class road, it's not even remotely close. So, you know, because the farther you go up the road, there's some culverts that active water currently is being, you know, routed. So there's 4 or 5 new water bars that would be filled in. And then the bottom, when I say the bottom piece, where the water bar is at the very
in kind of the entrance,
by
right
the home,
the entrance, yeah.
That we would move that water bar up to where, just down from where the field access there on the left is, and move the water, so we move the water bar so it gets right into the ditch line there, so there'd be some minor upgrades, because right now the water flows all the way down to the home, and then it hits a 90-degree water bar to go into the ditch, and if you get a large flow, it's just going to come into the road. So he thought by putting a 45 angled water bar up by the field entrance, we can get it and probably do maybe 100 feet of ditching.
Where are you going to put the water bar there? The road is down here and the banks are up here. Where are you going to put a water bar on above the...
Well, a combination of that and bringing in a load or two of gravel that we would fix that bottom piece.
In water bar towards the field?
No, towards the ditching.
Towards the existing ditch that's here.
There's no ditch here.
Yeah, there is.
But you can make one.
Yeah.
And so that would be a short term. That would be the short term thing. So putting back the water bars that were dug, and then just doing some minor work on that bottom, we'll call it bottom, I don't know, 200 or 300 feet of road to get the water at the bottom of the hill into the correct ditch. And then I think it becomes this much larger conversation, like Carl was saying, not just for what do we do with Gilead Road, but what do we start doing with, you know, endless of dozens of other roads that are in very similar situations in Bethel, which might be partnering with our neighbor, asking for help from Two Rivers or the state, or biting off these single-handedly as we approach them.
Yeah, and I think that's what we're getting at, that you do it in that matrix way. You've got to look at it like your other road survey and your capital plan for your road improvements, and you need to have somebody do more than what we've done in terms of actually, I mean, we could easily throw some out because you just can't figure out where they are legally. But there are others that somebody's going to have to walk on them, and it's going to have to be some authority other than, you know, a few neighbors in that are got some volunteer time.
Right.
Yeah.
Like you find with the A&R, you got to have people who are being paid to,
exactly,
in a professional capacity to make these kinds of designs and these kinds of decisions. And we all have, you know, practical knowledge, and we can stick our neck out a little way, but we're not going to, I don't think it makes sense for us to.
Yeah, that's a great idea. I'll reach out to Two Rivers and see what we can do for finding a survey for that. I think that's a great idea. And if the Class 4 Road Committee has any specific roads where they can't find the roadbed and they want to make, and they say, you know, just let me know and say, Therese, this is definitely a road you guys need to look at about whether we're going to throw it up, discontinue, throw it up, whatever. But I think that's an excellent idea, and I'll reach out to Rita this week and ask her about, we've already done our whole, you know, inventory of roads and culverts and road erosion and working on our hydrologically connected segments and all that. So I'll ask them about that.
So, and along with that, the White Road Partnership started about 10 years ago doing water quality assessment on fourth class roads and for several of the towns in the White River watershed.
Okay, good. I'll reach
out
to her. So
they may have a lot of really pretty comprehensive data about stream crossings and water and roadbeds and so forth. So
okay, I'll reach out to her.
They're very biased. They're very biased on what they consider water quality. You saw the pictures I showed you. Then we want to investigate it. A little trickle of water going into, they're very biased to the farmer. A little trickle of water going in the farmer's field, all of a sudden we're not a big water quality issue. He can pasture 50 cows in the watershed, 30 acres of the watershed, about a billion. And this is not a water quality issue?
They researched
and
it.
We have to
they follow that.
You read the article. There's a big, the agency of the Department of Agriculture and the ANR are both turning their backs on this. There's 88 cases in Vermont right now. It's going to come to a head eventually. You're not going to get away with it forever. So
okay.
I mean, right now, all we can control at the town level is how it impacts, well, it's selfish to say, but how it impacts the town.
Right.
I mean, the private disturbances will have to be settled, you know, privately. But in this case where there's a shared interest of a town road and some private landowners, you know, we had acted as a board last time to say, okay, the most recent work on the, like Carl said, there's a lot of work that's gone on that road over decades, but just the most recent work, we're gonna put the recent work back. We're not gonna direct that it be done by others. We're just gonna go up there with the grader, and we're gonna fix it ourselves, and maybe do a couple of minor things while we're up there, and then...
Are the culverts functional that have been put in there over the years?
The three culverts we looked at today had running water.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How far did you go all the way to town line?
We went,
Almost. To the fly, you can see it right before.
There's like six or seven, eight culverts.
Yeah, there's something.
So I guess what we were looking at doing right now was to fill in those water bars that were recently put in, do a little minor grade while we're up there, because we're going to be there, and then re-ditch the water on the very bottom end of the 200 or 300 feet of road there from the field entrance down to the house to get the water into the ditch line sooner rather than have it come down just cool where it is right now.
You're going to have to do a ditch all the way up too then, right?
There's no
ditch from Andrew's house up to the second parkway. There's no ditch. Zero ditch.
Right, I understand that.
So see, then
the
shedboard's
going to be some minor ditching.
So that's kind of where we're at now. Now, there's obviously going to be some long-term discussions on, do we keep it a class 3 road? Do we change it to class 4? Do we do upgrades? What upgrades do we do to it? And how does that impact the dozens of other roads that have been similar situation? I know it's probably not exactly what both of you are looking for, but that's kind of what we've decided as a town for now.
I can live with that, but then when that gets all done and he goes up with his manure spread and ruins that ditch that you do, then what? Who's going to pay for that? Who's going to fix that? Taxpayers again?
Well,
are you going to put some kind of weight restriction on that road so that he's not pulling 50, 60,000 pounds or however much it weighs up there? Because that's what ruined the ditches in the first place.
Well, I think
I don't think so. That's it.
You know, and I think that's kind of those are the issues that the town is facing on numerous roads for different. Someone may be agricultural related, someone may be recreational related, someone might just be regular erosion related. But we have those issues going on. I mean, I think it's something bigger issue that we're going to work on. It's not going to get settled now, or maybe next year, or year after that.
That Gilead Brook Road is one of the most used recreational roads. So there are people who use it
right.
A lot with no seasonal or any kind of regulation
say that Vermont wants to see more recreational usage on these roads, maybe we look at the ones that get the most usage now and start.
Those are the roads you need to fix up so that they can be maintained, so people can use them like that, the other ones we throw up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then we go from there, you know. So.
And I think, too, you could talk to a lot of vast White Valley Ramblers and I can't remember the name of the vast ATV group.
If the town plants a road, you can preclude all public use of it. You can make it a legal trail. It's only for pedestrians.
Right.
And in a case like that, private landowners can make arrangements with VASS if they want to have seasonal rights of ways, so that you don't have to be entirely beholden to those arrangements.
Yeah.
But you can close them, or you can throw them up, or you can change their uses. But you have to have some kind of public education. Once you start getting ready to close these roads down, they become private land. And you have to have some way to protect those private landowners from any kind of use. And we had several people give us testimony that they had 4x4s backed up in the driveway looking for the old stage road, for example, that is supposed to be at the end of their driveway. But there's nothing but lawn there. And the stage road has been unused for so long that there's no place for them to go. So if you start taking roads where people have been going, and you start changing their classification, then we need to figure out how we're going to educate people so that private land is protected.
Right.
That's a good point, whether you gate it or pent it or
you're
whatever.
You're going to have some kind of sign there with some kind of authority so that when somebody decides that my grandfather took me on this road, I should be able to go on it because it was a class 4 road 50 years ago. Mm-hmm. Who's going to remediate that issue?
When people drove after ancient roads, I don't think that was done. It was a few years ago, everybody went through the whole ancient road. Roads were discontinued, but you're right, there was no sign put up that said this is no longer whatever. It just was, it seemed like everyone in the state was doing it at the same time. We were all under the same statutory timeline, I believe.
Right.
So you're right.
That's why I say it's a state issue.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, well, isn't it true? I mean, that's why.
But it is. It's big, though.
You're absolutely right.
I know it doesn't solve anything for the select board meeting, but I'm interested in seeing what kind of a collaborative approach can be created, because you have to actually have communication with the towns on your periphery if you have roadways that connect, because both of you can make decisions about whether or not those are roadways that you all want to connect, keep you connected, and then the state can come in because the state is implementing trying to implement water quality control.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of hard for the committee to make decisions and the road crew to keep up with it, but in the interim.
I think that's a great idea. So getting some information from Two Rivers and from Ware Valley Partnership, putting it together, kind of started looking at places, reaching out to these other town select boards and saying, hey, we're looking in at this section of roads. These are the roads that come into your town. What do you have on your side?
Reaching out to the clubs that are using the roads now.
Yeah.
They'll probably give you a better picture of which roads are getting used more than others. And if it's a road that's being shared between, let's say, us and Rochester, then we could meet with Rochester to say, what do you think about upgrading or putting more money into this thing?
Yeah, that's what I can ask.
Or if it's not being used, it's,
do we
use a different classification of the roadway?
I'll make a note of that.
And then we had, and then up on the right road, there was some discussion about some tree clearing.
Yep.
And Teresa and I took a ride up there today. A little more difficult to get through there to pick up than I thought it would be, but it's got some challenges, and in some spots it's probably only about 8 feet wide, but it's
it's another one of the, and when I was up there today, Carol, and I was thinking about when I first came to the board, there was a discussion at that time about how it's Class 3 road up to the house, and I think a quarter mile past the house currently is
there's
Class
some
3.
Distance, yeah, yeah.
And then it turns into Class 4 from there to
Rochester
limit. And I know we had talked about potentially taking that quarter mile chunk and back it down.
Yeah, well, Keith was the manager at the time, and that was something we talked about, but I don't think we progressed very far on it.
Like basically where the gate's at now, like that would be Class 3, and then we change to 4 right there.
Yeah, that was the discussion we had was trying to evaluate what the differential was in terms of the Class 3 highway certificate.
Yeah, the state highway. I actually saw some. I pulled it tonight when we got back looking, and I did find an email between you and Keith talking about this. Mm-hmm. Keith had gone. There were some pictures where he'd driven a stake, mm-hmm. and then there was some math on a piece of paper about it, what it would take to upgrade it versus, you know, taking it from Class 3 to
yeah.
4. But there was an email exchange between you two. I found it in those folders that you were talking about mm-hmm. earlier, so I did take a peek at it tonight. So I can tell it kind of stalled out right there.
Which is what happens a lot, and which is the road
still
get carried forward. Mm-hmm. But I don't think that the state isn't maybe from what you said earlier, the state's putting a little more scrutiny on that, so that your third class road certificate is going to have to be tighter, I guess. Possibly as you move forward, and so that's another kind of equipment.
Yeah.
But again, that's another one that, you know, once you get to where the true Class 4 limits are, I mean, it's, you know, it's not impassable, but it, you know, it takes a little bit of work to get through there.
And that road does not, and there's no Rochester Road on the other side of the
right.
line.
That's another good example of what we're talking
so
about.
So, and if you actually respect the private property owners, you probably wouldn't be able to turn around. It might be wide enough, but you know that the turnaround is in the Class 4 right away.
You're right.
Yeah.
It's a good
you
point.
Don't.
Yeah.
And so as a private owner, as a public traveler on these roads, you're making big assumptions because you see wheel tracks in front of you.
But yeah, I mean, but we have to, you know, the first part of the permitting process there was identifying the roads that you have. Now they're actually going to start looking for you to upgrade 10 or 15% each year of the roads that don't meet the standard currently. And you have to send that information to the state, you know, with a little bit of proof saying we did this work.
Yep, by 2022. So anyways.
So you have like 10 years to upgrade all the roads.
No, you said next year, end of 2022.
Well,
so it's a question. We do have, what obligation do we have to maintain a road so that there is access to all property owners along that strip?
If it's Class 4?
Either, any. We can't abandon if there is a property there, right? Or can we?
Yeah.
Sure, yeah, you can. There's a process for it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you can. There's a statutory process if you were going to throw up, say, Class, you know, 4 road or... I mean, Class 3, obviously, a better maintained section of Class 3. This is a poor example of Class 3 road. But there is a statutory process for the Select Board to throw up or discontinue a road. So, and chances are, if somebody lives off from a Class 4 road anyways, they probably already have, they have a right of way over it, and they already maintain it or, you know, have that. Figure out how to get to their own property because we're not plowing. Like somebody who lives on a ranch, for example, we don't go all the way up there in the winter. So someone that has a home up there, so they access either via snowmobile, they don't go up there in the winter, or what. So you don't have an obligation to the legally to the people. This process.
I think that the obligation on roads is not to provide access to private ownership, it's to provide public safety for people traveling on the
right-of-way.
So the assumption is that somebody traveling there is going to one of the properties, but I think that a lot of these different basis for the certificate is to maintain road safety for people to travel on.
So Carl, if someone, if you delay this class 4 road, you get back in the private neighborhood, and there's another neighborhood beyond you who has a piece of property, and he's never cut no right away because he didn't need to because the town right away was bigger. How does that work with the, I don't know if it's a statute or whatever, but the state of Vermont said, who shall never landlock a piece of property?
Yeah, I think you have to grant that person right away.
You have to, so you can't get that part of the process.
Because the town has the right of way now across the adjacent property. Okay,
that's my question.
It would basically be, you would take your right of way, the town's right of way, and bequeath it to the property owner that was.
I just want to make sure that I set the right of way and say, ooh,
that.
But it becomes a private road.
Okay.
So, and that's where the issue is that now you've got whatever Sunday traffic was on that road with four wheelers, and you decide that it's only going to be a right of way to one property, then you inadvertently put all that depression right on that private property. Mm-hmm.
But they could make the decision. Carl's right, and there's right. You can't create a landlocked piece of land, and so, but hence, you know, that's why people say sometimes in their deed. We've talked about this before with another piece of property, Mr. Sharp, I think. We talked about this because maybe just because someone's property doesn't necessarily outline their access, it's because someone, the only one who can grant someone authority to use a town road is the town. So in some cases, even if you discontinue a road, they might actually be able to take legal action against the person who, you know, owned the other property. So they're owns the property, so it becomes a sticky wicket. So he's right, as far as discontinue, you grant someone a right of way just to make it a clear ownership for a deed.
I think that example you just brought is a good one, because we joked about that a little bit on our committee, because, the town could say, oh, we don't want to fix this road up, let's just grant the right of way. But then it's like, where is the right of way?
Exactly.
That
was another question going through my mind. If you were to give up any of these roads, we have to know where they are.
Yeah.
Because now we've got private property deeds that need to be written in such a way that they can be.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So I think it's really complicated, but I think that, if these were my assets, I don't think they're really defined well enough for me to feel secure about them at all.
That's a good point, Carl. And you're right, it's not just our issue.
So in regards to the right road piece with the tree cutting, earth clearing, as needed, I mean, just like our permitting process is right now, is to get permission to do work inside the right road. But the question has become, as you walk through that piece of road at first, it's the same landowner on both sides of the road for like the first, half mile or something.
Not quite that far.
And then your land's on the left and your land's on the right and you're heading up right. And so right now, Brian wants to do a little bit of trimming, tree clearing up on his side, but also wants to do some on the left side of the road, is that correct?
In the right of the NYD. NYD. I've got a deed right away that says I can laundry it.
You gave us one that said that there was a right of way on there and it had talked about it, and there was some back and forth between your own lawyers. But when you drove up anyways, when you started driving up, there wasn't a lot of brush on first part right before your camp that actually looked pretty nice. Must be you've done that in the last few years, and then
the bank part,
it looks nice.
But
then
a lot of it on the left hand side, I got through the tree. Eventually, I'm thinking maybe my grandkids might build a house up there. I need two lots out.
when they widen that road to make it so it's year-round passable, it's going to be a lot cheaper than it is cutting a tree like this. Plus, it's the danger of it's too close to the road. These trees are too close to the road.
They're perfectly live trees. You don't need to worry
that
about falling.
That isn't what my deed said. My deed said I can cut 35 feet.
My deed says you can. And my deed is probably as important as yours.
So I guess what we, Teresa and I were riding up through there today trying to, envision
where you want to cut trees. We were trying to look
at that legal opinion, I guess, on my end of things is kind of simple. A person owns the property on the right side, can get permission from the town to do some tree collecting, and the person on the left side, can do it. Or you guys can work out a mutual, agreement that, it's okay if you cut these three trees or something that are on my side. But when it comes to, can somebody go from one side of the road to the other because that tree may or may not affect their side of the road, it becomes the argument.
How does the tree policy, what is the standard for the tree policy on a fourth class road? Because on my third class road, next to Billy, I can't go cut a tree down.
Right.
With the standing next to the road, I need to get permission and
right.
That's the way.
So I own that land. Mm-hmm. I own the land that MacIntosh travels across. So it's no different than if I had the right of way deed. So your town tree policy trumps the right of way.
And the state
of the right of way.
Right, yeah. And the state law says that that the towns have, within the town's right-of-way, that we have the authority to allow or not someone to cut trees within our right-of-way.
Right.
And so basically, Wright Road, when it continues on to Rochester, is still a town right-of-way, so we can control who cuts trees and who doesn't within our right-of-way.
Right.
And we had that conversation
today. So I think the first step is... It was good that Brian reached out to get permission to, cut trees rather than just do it, right? So, and that's the first, good step is to reach out and get the permission of what you've done. And it seems like, obviously, from what trees and I saw, there had been the first kind of quarter mile was really well kept on both sides of the road, really good. And then once you get more into the, the fourth class road as it, there's a lot of obstacles, right? There's ledge, there's some rock faces, there's some really close trees the side of the road that make it, tight. And how it is, we did, when Teresa and I were driving up through, for the most part, the road looked pretty good. We were looking for dead trees or possible trees that could fall on the road and stuff like that. Didn't really see. There were two that we had brought up to your attention that are sitting on your land that are, one is a dead tree that's just leaning over that could fall into the road at any time. Maybe those would be opportunities to work together to clean those up when you're going up through there.
They're not working together here.
Well, I guess my opinion and recommendation for it after looking at it today would be, to allow Brian to do some tree clearing on his side of the fourth class road.
I understand, right? But his lawyer sent me a letter saying he's trying to take my right away. That's what he's doing. I've got a written right away that my two uncles granted, and they passed it on to go to the church law and the Granger law. They reserved the right to widen that road from 25 feet. One side in the center of the road, whether it's a class four road or not.
No, that's not. That's not how it.
Well, I don't. Well, okay.
As long as the town owns the road.
Yes. Yeah, and that only takes place if the town throws up the road.
No, it doesn't say anything about the town throwing up the road. It says in here whether it is a town road or not.
I don't know how a lawyer could give you or anybody the right. Over town road. The only one who could give you or Carl or anybody the right to expand the town's right of way or to build out that road would be the town. Nobody would have had the legal authority to grant anyone the right to do something over a town road except for the town. And your deed, you know, from what I've read that you sent, obviously the town didn't grant that. That's something that was somehow done, you know, amongst other people. And we did not, as I said, spend money to get a legal opinion on your deeds. We didn't do that. That's, you know, between you two, that's a certainly a civil matter, so.
But it's not, it's a town now, because it's a town right away. And besides him trying to take my right away, he's also taking your right away. He's saying that you can't, he doesn't want anything cut on his side. That's your right away.
It's true, it is. And when Chris and I went up and looked at it, that was exactly what we were saying. What did we think needed to be trimmed on either side of the road? What we were looking at. We were both looking at it. You know, obviously.
And
we're
trying to avoid all the potholes.
We're not loggers and foresters here.
So
and boulders, but
so
yeah.
If I wanted to upgrade that road to, say, up to class 3 spec and pay for it myself, how much would you let me charge?
You don't. Does the town make a commitment to accepting a class 3 road before?
It's something that they have to consider, because, you know, for someone to bring that up to like A76 or B72 standards, it's very expensive. And whether the town, you know, it's rare that a town would agree to take on more responsibility or more road, because you're right, you'd have to bring it up to standard. The select board would have to, you'd have to go through a bunch of hoops, engineered, and have it brought up to a standard with an agreement or hope that what the select board was going to agree to take it on, because normally last thing any town generally wants is more road to maintain. And once you had done that and the town accepted, it became their responsibility. So I'm not really sure.
I mean, it's probably not.
Let's forget the class 3 part then. I want to upgrade it so it's a lot better passable for myself, to my lots up there.
They're under no obligation to do so.
If I want to do it to make the road better to my lot.
Well, he can, you know, you can put in a request.
Yeah, the road alteration.
The route, the permit.
Construction type permit.
Through the permit, yeah.
Road. But when I do that, are you going to come up and listen to him and say, well, he's a poor farmer at the end of the road, he doesn't want his trees cut, so we're not going to grant you that from you.
Well, I guess it would depend on the road work with the title. I mean, if it was just going to be in road work only, it wasn't going to affect any
it's
of the property on the left side of the road, then, I mean, it's a case-by-case basis.
It is, and it's a hard issue because if we don't know exactly where the roadbed lies originally, it's tough for the, you know, it's tough to look at. And there's a policy for it, the highway, you know, there's a permit to put in, there's a policy to go through, we'd have to look at it, but it's a trick because that road, you have some ledge that's over here on an outcrop and you have a stone wall here. You know, that would be something we'd have to do some research for to see if, is there documentation in the past? Where exactly is this a roadbed? We even know where it existed originally as to how the road was laid out. So it's not a cut and dried issue and certainly not anything that anyone's going to answer tonight.
Because I'm basically losing complete control over my roadway to my property. Between what you're saying and what he's saying. And I've got written
no,
in the
no, you don't.
I don't think you're
not
losing any control over it. I mean,
you don't have a right, you have a right of way if there's no public right of way, but since there's a public right of way, your right of way is redundant. It doesn't have value.
No.
Now, the only way you have that right of way is if the town right of way gets
redundant.
But isn't my written deed mean nothing?
No, it means that you have a right-of-way that does not exist, but there's a public right-of-way that exists.
So if the town all of a sudden, because that's fourth class road for most
people. So you're
not
losing that.
If the town decided to throw that, let's say at your house, we decided that where it ends at the farm, we're gonna end it, right? We're gonna throw that road up and it's no longer gonna be a fourth class, well, part third class, but fourth class road.
Yeah.
Then your deed would grant you right now, have to look at more
specific
access to your property.
With specific rights.
Right, with specific rights. But right now, being that the town has fourth class road here, or third class.
you have the same rights that he does to use that road, and any other property owner that may be, you know, I don't know, anybody else is up there, but I don't think so. But you guys need equal rights to the road, basically. However, the general permit to do work in the right of way, for the most part, isn't for us to say we don't want you to do work in the right of way, because we want to encourage you to upgrade the road and make it better and do water quality and stormwater, you know, revisions. It's just more about we want to know what we're doing. So like,
there's a permit.
So we know, like, hey, we put two culverts in, you know, or did certain work rather than, you know, like Carol was saying on Gilead, you know, somebody at some point put a culvert in. Nobody knows what did that, you know. But it's just giving some documentation of the work that's being done out there. So in this case, with the tree clearing, you know, the select board can weigh in. Is, you know, Therese and I felt that anything on your side of the road, if you wanted to tree, you know, we personally didn't think that there was a lot of tree clearing or trimming that needed to be done. We thought it was actually in pretty good shape. But if you wanted to do some on that, we didn't see any issue with that.
On your side of the road.
Right. We did.
So you're telling him he can't cut on his side of the road?
We're going to ask him to mark some trees that we saw that were dead.
We
saw that were dead and that were leaning that we think
needed. How about the ones that are almost from your truck when you're driving by?
I mean, we did recommend that there, you know, we did see a couple of trees that were literally leaning over in the road that, you know, that should be taken care of, and that could be either or not. You know, either when you're clearing it, he could ribbon off three trees and say, can you take those three too?
This is,
or maybe he has to take care of it himself, but that was kind of the way we looked at it. I mean,
basically, unfortunately, we are not a judicial body, so we cannot resolve the legal dispute that you have with the other gentleman here regarding what your deed right-of-way includes or not. The information that was provided to us also indicates that there is a second opinion on that. That is a legal discussion that we don't have any jurisdiction or capacity to solve. What Chris is suggesting is in fact your best option, even though you don't believe that the two of you can get together to resolve anything. But I would request that both of you agree to decide whether or not the trees that you would like to remove are, if there is any reason from your perspective that he could not remove. And if there is, kind of figure it out and do that as two human beings, even though you say that you've got years of contentious relationship. I'm respectfully requesting that the two of you sit down as adults and say, here's what I would like, here's what I can do. And that you find a way, and if you need somebody to kind of be a mediator in that, figure out how to do that. But what you're bringing to us, a legal issue, we do not have the authority to resolve. If both of you were to, if you agree that this could be taken down on my side that's in the right of way, and you agree this can be taken out in my side and it's in the right of way, I'm sure that the select board will try to facilitate what you have mutually agreed. But we don't have authority to do what you're asking.
So who does?
If you two have a disagreement between your deeds, then you two, it's a civil matter, and you two would have to work it out between
they need to be.
No, no, that's fine.
So anyway, back to the issue of him kicking people off the road. Town can't kick the town can't do anything about that. That's your right of way. And it's supposed to, the town is supposed to be promoting the recreation and for people's enjoyment using these town roads. When he's kicking them off in there, in my family, people that are going to my camp, that's, isn't that an issue that you guys are partially responsible for?
Well, people, obviously the road is open. I mean, if people are driving up the
you
road.
You don't understand.
No, it just doesn't.
You think that people probably come to you at the town office.
I haven't had any.
Well, Brian, that he's strong arms. Well, I, you know something, and I really kind of overlooked this when I hired a lawyer to take care of this strong arm and this bullying and this kicking. He kicked my own family off, going up to the intel or runs up, chasing them up the road.
No.
But the town would have to keep public use open on that road. That's
absolutely. Yeah. So this is what I'm asking. This is why I want your legal counsel. I'm going to sit down with him, and I want to give him the witnesses that will testify in court of law. They have to that he is stolen off, and he is not allowing us to enjoy our right to enjoy our property. And he's done it for 35 years.
I guess what I would say on this is the right road, correct?
Yeah. Yeah.
So on the right road, I mean, it technically is a public roadway, right? So anybody can enjoy that road. However,
yes,
it is landlocked. Well, I mean, up through there, it's either your property or your property. So it's kind of one of those things that anybody that's going to go up there and use the road is going to have to either be a visitor of yours or a visitor of yours, right? Because once you get up here, it's all private property, right? I mean, there's no town.
You're saying that you could assume that they would be.
Yeah, right? I mean, but everybody, I mean, Dave, myself, everybody's got the same equal rights to access that road. Typically, the people that probably would access that road would be some sort of relation to the landowners, I think, because of the location and the privatization of the land there.
Unless they're traveling, they're following a dirt road,
right,
and they don't know where the Rochester town line is, yeah, and they don't realize that this fourth class road extends into a farm right away.
And then ends.
So then you have a landowner who wants to know who's driving on.
Right. So I mean, but
it's more than just, when he chases people down the road, they walk from my camp.
I don't have that kind of time to do that.
Okay. So I would just say,
he's lying.
At this point, I would just say, if there are any issues with it not being accessible for all, then the individuals that are being impacted need to come to the town to write out an affidavit that they can't use for whatever reason, and then we can contact them and discuss it. And work through the streets.
That's what I'm coming
not
for.
Going past. We're saying from here going forward. Because we're saying from here going forward, people have the right to access your camp and to access, their best property. It is a town, currently a town situation. So yes, from this point forward, if somebody is deterred from accessing your camp, then definitely let me know dates, times, who it is, and we will deal with that, absolutely, because it can be happening. Derek, better understand that.
It's happened twice this summer.
Well, like we're saying, going forward from this date on.
Happened in the past, you can't.
If there's an issue with breaking down the town, it's no different than you can't gate roads and things like that. There are certain legal reasons why we can't, restrict access to public roads, right? So,
right.
If you put a piece of equipment in the way or if you put a gate up or whatever, you can't do that. So, if that happens, then it's, go over to Therese because she's the town manager, and then you can.
And that would include intimidation.
And that's what's happened in the past. That's what I've had enough of.
So what the board is suggesting to you is that in the future, anyone comes to you and said that they were harassed intimidated, they felt intimidated, or whatever. And I'm saying this so you're hearing it too. That individual needs to contact the town office and file an official complaint. That we can respond to. We need to respond to it from the person who felt intimidated, and as close to the time of the intimidation as reasonably possible.
And we can always get as possible and definitely be able to, absolutely. Absolutely. If someone stops to say, hey, who's driving up the road to see who it is, they're going up to your camp, it's, you know, just wave and hey. If they know the person especially, I mean, let's face it, you're related, you probably know each other's families, then let them go. If it's a stranger with New Jersey plates, I would expect you would stop them at your camp and say, hey, where are you going? You know, you need to turn around here, the road ends or whatever. I would expect the same thing from
because they're following the GPS
something happens.
Rushes.
Yeah, absolutely not. People are authorized. You guys know each other's family.
But I mean, I would recommend on the legal end of things is, you know, you can get a mediator, sit down, go through your deeds, and, you know, try to find some sort of common ground or resolution on, you know, going forward on certain you know, deed restrictions that you have on one side of the road versus the other.
So back to the trees, I want to cut back so that two cars can pass.
Good Lord.
Not on that road.
Holy cow.
Interesting, I think what the guy we talked was saying, let you trim on stuff on your side of the road, and we'll get, you know, some of the dead stuff on the other side, we will ask Derek to mark. But you can't really make that too. I mean, between the rock and the stone wall.
Why can't I cut trees that are 4 feet from the road? I understand the big maple, I'm not going to cut it. I'm interested in cutting the stuff maybe 5 inches and down that's growing too close to the road. It's growing way too close to the road.
Like we said, the trees that are on your side of the road, so going up upright road, the trees that are on your right side of the road would be the ones that we talked about that we're good to move. Select the cutting or clearing inside the town right away. But anything on the left side of the road, that would have to be something that you would mutually agree upon, or something that, you know, would go out and rip it off or whatever to say that I would really cut. At this point, unless we get something else given to us.
Yeah.
And if there's any down
the road, the farmer's going to win.
No, it's about, and going forward, if you have any, you know, potential upgrades to the road that you want to do, like we talked about, you wipe down or grading it, gravel in it, then, you know, by all means, get Therese involved on what the potential is that you want to do for work up there, and we'll work with you on allowing
you know, it's reasonable work. It's bad enough so that I even considered selling out, because that's how bad it is. He's driven one couple of already. Eric threw him dying.
So well, like we're saying, it's raised the access to it. So,
anyway, if I was to sell this piece of property, okay, sell it to Dave, okay, Dave comes up, and the first time he wants to have a family walking up there, come on and have a cookout, him and his wife chase you up the road. Where the hell are you going? This is private property up here. Dave only owns a tiny piece of the land up here. We own all the rest, and it's private, and you've got to come to us and ask to use this road. And then, so if I sell him, Dave's going to say, he's going to start asking around. Because it's common knowledge. Carl knows. He's a pain in the ass. He drives people off. Carl knows all about it. It's going on for 23
years. Like we said, if there's any issues up there, have the party involved.
No, so
directly contact with them.
Yeah.
If I sell it to Dave, and then Dave starts talking around his neighbors, and they said, oh yeah, he's been like that for 35 years, kicking people out. That's why Brian sold it. Brian's going to be in a lawsuit for selling that piece of property.
One of the truisms of negotiation is that you assume that you have already have a pact of mutual distrust. But each of you are going to do that which is in your own best interest. And that's where a mediator can work with you so that you get what's in your best interest and respects that you don't trust Derek. And Derek gets what's in his interest and respects that he doesn't trust you. That's not the job of a select board. That is a legal issue. And I'm just encouraging you, even on the basis of mutual distrust, after 35 years of relationship, however strained that's been, there's something in there where you are mutually, that can be mutually advantageous. I recommend, urge, encourage, suggest that each of you consider some sort of mediation to resolve this. It's not going to happen here, not going to happen with the ANR, because that's not what our jobs are. Our job is to maintain the road. Our job is to police the road so that it is accessible to all persons. But our job is not to resolve your issues. And it's not because we are prejudiced or biased in favor of agriculture or in favor of private property owners. It is because that's all we can do. It's all we are legally able to do. In the future, if you have an individual who feels threatened, coerced, harassed, whatever, have that individual contact the town office and we will act as we would with anyone encroaching town property.
Constable, I don't care. So yeah, obviously everybody has access to that road. And that's, you know, that's headed up there. And you should know each other, you know, families and friends and stuff. But absolutely, let me know and we will deal with it.
And I have to.
Because that's unacceptable.
And I can only cut in the town right away the trees that you tell them I can cut, correct?
The trees that are on your side of the road.
No, I'm talking about in the right way.
Or any other. Or any other that he agrees to on his side of the road.
That he agrees to?
On his side of the road.
So then you're biased right there, you're taking his side out?
He's a landowner on one side of the road, and you're a landowner on the other side. So you can cut trees on his side of the road.
It's a town road.
It doesn't matter. He's a landowner on one side of the road, you're a landowner on the other side of the road.
We're biased towards
him. I mean, that doesn't make it that my neighbor down the road that I can walk across the street and cut his trees down. I mean, it doesn't work that way. So,
but if you had a reason, the town could send the road through out.
Absolutely.
Or cut it free on any side of the road.
That's what we did today.
Those people operating as agents for the town.
Exactly.
And that's what we did today.
That's for sure.
So you can't just, we public can't just assume agency for the town to go out and take care of your hazards.
No, we went out and took a look today,
and we saw two or three trees that
I'm
were.
I'm just trying to draw a distinction for Brian. Brian's wanting to take care of a section of road that he uses, but I do the same thing on my property, but I can't act as an agent for the town to address hazards that don't belong to me because I'm not an agent.
Exactly.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, I when I go down the road to my neighbors, it's no longer my road. I can't decide that there are trees that would benefit me to be removed. That's a town
right
decision, a road crew decision, or a tree ward decision. So that's all I'm trying to say is that you're on one side and you can make those decisions on yours. If you're going to make decisions on the other side of the road, you have to make sure that those decisions that are suitable with the written bed, or you have to make an argument
in
town that the town go out to take care of them.
Yeah.
I'll have to look into this written right away that I've got to look into. Steve Webster did it. You know Steve. Steve just took dots his eyes and crossed.
And Steve's still on, so you can ask him about. Obviously, you have a letter from Rick and Bev's attorney who is telling you that your interpretation is different than theirs. So ask Steve. Steve's, you're right. And then you guys can.
So for now, like you said,
going to grant your request.
I'm on your side, and if it's a convenience factor, there are a couple that we had pointed out today that are on the other side of the road. If you want to take care of those, and you make the agreement, and that's fine. But that would be just those, you know. Mm-hmm. So, and if you come up with any other information, just feel free to share that with Therese and the board, and, you know, go from there. So, appreciate you guys' time this evening. We are going to move forward with the rest of our agenda. If you have anything else, feel free to reach out to us.
What is your, what's the town's stance on, I'd like to know what is your stance on water pollution, clean water?
If this is in regards to the other stuff about A&R and the cows and stuff, it's beyond our purview. The thing about Vermont is a Dillon's rule state. We only have the authority granted to us by the state. The state is the one who has set the rules for stormwater and water quality, who's enforcing those. We don't currently have a policy or a town ordinance that I can think of in this second that is about stormwater, whether we have horses in a crossing or this or that. That I do know that the state of Vermont, because I asked Jim Gray today, that the state of Vermont did just change some agricultural, which used to be agricultural best practices, to agricultural regulations. So, but that's something that where ag and that is definitely covered by A&R and not within our purview as the town of Bethel.
But I'm just asking you, what is your stance on the town started? You promote clean water, right? You promote clean water everywhere.
I think at this point, Brian, what we're saying is we're going to move forward with the rest of our agenda for this evening. And
we go ahead. Okay.
So, budget?
So we had the piece of the budget, I guess, when you had written. So there's the budget pieces that are in there, but there's also this human service appropriations. Is that something that you added in there, Paul, or is that?
Yeah.
You want to talk about that? So the way it works out in the past, we take in the applications from various nonprofits that have historically requested appropriations. So we started to ask questions to make sure that the folks that we were giving the money to actually service Bethel residents. And so we changed the wording a little bit this year to get to ask that they give us more specific detail, numbers of people that they have serviced, and get a little more detail with how they actually work with Bethel residents. So out of the first five that we got in, three of them don't service any Bethel residents.
Oh, wow.
So the question came up then, how do we want to look at the appropriations concept and change it? Do we want to focus more on Bethel groups that don't necessarily apply for it now, like the food shelf or Boy Scouts or whatever? So I'm just asking for an opinion. I'm not asking for a decision, and I'm just looking to get some conversation about the direction that we should go.
So when you say currently serve zero Bethel residents,
right?
Is there any historical data? I mean, just because there's none now, did they serve some 5 years ago?
Well, we have to go back and look. But for example, Quintown Senior Center over in the But they could.
But they could.
Well, that was going to be my next question, is there any futuristic opportunities for Bethel residents to use these services even though they're not now?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Modern Bellburn, I mean, there's certainly an opportunity there for anybody who wants to be involved in the programs, but currently there aren't.
So does your criteria ask for organizations currently that are serving people in Bethel? Or is that a filter that you want to discuss?
That's what I wanted to discuss. It's part of, it has, historically, it's been in the letters that we send out. And over the course of time, it used to be when I first got involved that they were more specific with how many folks that they serviced. But now it has started to kind of drift in a different direction. There are still some, like Clark Martin, for example, the Mont Transit, those folks, they're still very specific about how many calls they had, or how many students they took care of after school, things like that.
You're saying early on so far that you've recognized three.
Right.
Currently don't have any membership. Could in the future.
Right.
And what to do with
it. So I guess the question is, do we continue to support these organizations because they historically have applied and have received appropriation money?
How often has the list changed?
It doesn't really change that much. It very rarely has a new group come on.
Yeah, it's pretty consistent.
It's pretty consistent.
It might be one that comes on and off, take the other.
And we have some that also apply that are, we ask for financials. And they're obviously not a profit, but they're a group, they're an organization that services, let's say, Windsor County, but not specific to Bethel.
Of course, I think also where Paul's going to go with this a little bit too is, we do have some of these human services that appropriations that aren't at the level that the identities would like to see funded too. So there's always tri-towns, exactly, where they say, Bethel's piece should be, $8,000 a year, but you're only currently giving us six, based on ride share and things like that. So I think where Paul might be going with this a little bit too is that, there are some identities that are getting zero Bethel usage at them currently. Would some of that money be better appropriated towards the other services that are getting more usage, maybe?
Like reallocating the money?
Or is that becoming a metric that's overblown?
Right.
Has everybody stumbled over themselves to prove that they've got higher level of service to this town, or are you going to evaluate the services based on the potential clientele that they could serve and the need for those people to have that access when they need it?
And the requests are increasing. Everybody's under pressure right now. All of the service groups are under pressure. Situation. So I was just trying to get a little feel.
When are all the appropriations due by?
December 1st. We meet in the first week of December.
It might be best to just see what comes through. Or you may get some new ones that might pop up there. Or
I'm sorry, Paul. I don't remember off the top of my head. I feel like I've seen one, but does Bethel currently have a policy on? I feel like I've seen something about human services. I felt like I've read something in one of those books. Maybe a policy. Do you have a policy? A written policy about it? Let's look. I feel like I've seen something, but it could be just going through something old that I found something old. But I'll look and see.
I could say, from the perspective of someone who works in human services, I found the navigating process for municipal allocations really complicated and unclear and helpful. And I've worked with municipalities all around Vermont and New Hampshire, and those have a very clear policy on the how you bring it before the select board, and it's really clear for the human services providers. They also give really clear details, Paul, to your point, of what the request should entail, including the number of service and the number of citizens who will serve, or different formulas around funding. And I found that the process really hard to navigate. And Chris, I think years ago I talked with you about it, because it was really unclear to me how to access the process here. So I think that's a good point.
Which group were you with?
Well, I've worked at different nonprofits, but at that point I was working for a Stagecoach.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and I was the one who was first pushed it through for Stagecoach to receive funding, mm-hmm. but it was a really unclear, how to process.
So we currently have, let's say probably been a little more active the last couple years than it was, a few years prior to that. Is, we do have a human services committee that, just meets around the budgeting time, that does have, the certain criteria laid out for potential applicants of, the deadline and what couple of things that we look for, which is basically, what revenue are you looking for, and, any information on Bethel residents that you can provide. And they're all a little bit unique because some might deal with ride shares, and some, I always say Stagecoach, but they're under a different name now. We've had individuals come in and give us really good presentations in the past showing, not just ride share, but how that makes up, what personal visits they do, versus what, just random pickups, and, so we get a lot of data out of that. But it's all, it's kind of a, there really is no specific guidelines, I think, on it, which...
No, we ask for, we ask people to give us a specific number that they're asking for, because some of the groups don't do that. They leave that piece of the puzzle out. And then we also ask for financial information and specifically how they impact the town of Bethel. That's basically the three things that we ask. And we send a letter out in late October, and then we send another letter out in November, and we ask to have everything back by December 1st. And we still end up chasing people just to make sure that they didn't send it. We've had some that sent it electronically to the town clerk, because that's historically what they did. And we didn't find out about it because she thought it was something else. She thought it was an invoice for last year's appropriation, so we have to chase around those different elements.
And that was a good example of the in-person budget discussion is, we did 2 years ago, we had an issue where an existing human services, that's exactly what happened, is their application got mislabeled as a potential bill and put in a different pile. And we were able to vote from the town, from the floor that year, to add those appropriations that would have been left off by making an amendment to the budget, under the human services, where, if that was a Australian ballot type situation, you would have that option to make an error, type deal. And then we had another one the other year where we actually ended up doubling.
Yeah, somebody wrote it from the floor.
Because we had forgotten.
Had a prior year.
To do theirs the prior year. So there was some.
And people have voted from the floor to increase people's appropriations. Yeah. Well, I'm not sure if you've ever had any people motion or vote them, but I'll look and see what I see if I can.
They came in one time and had a regular appropriation, and then they gave a speech on the floor at a town meeting, and the town voted to increase the appropriation by another $3,000 or something.
But we also had, when I first got on the board years ago, there was, I can't remember which one of those, Carol, feel free to jump in, but there was an appropriation that, it was a small amount, I think it was $250 a year that we gave to this one identity that nobody even knew who the identity was.
It just passed through every
year. Yeah, and you just signed off every year, and we're like, who is this identity, Right. And then we found out, not only did we not know, they didn't provide any services to anything locally. It was like a world type organization.
I believe I was the one who raised the question about
Quintown last year.
Quintown.
Yeah, you did.
And whether, you know, why we were supporting that when we had agencies that were closer and more accessible.
Well, maybe something, I'll look for that, and maybe something that the, maybe some sort of people will get.
And
you know,
so I
calls.
Think.
I'll look at the statute, because there's some statutory stuff.
So I think the question of peak number of people served is relevant. I think also the question of whether or not the agency is has a service area that kind of officially, like it's the Windsor County or the Randolph area, you know, but what's their service area and how do and then we make a decision accordingly. But so
I think they're definitely good ones to take a look at and question as we get further into the process.
And I would suggest that if we are not supporting the food shelf, that we consider that.
Would that go down as a be a part of the human services appropriation, or would that go more under
just mean add to the budget, like
kind of like library and you know what section of the budget?
Well, there are some of those too that you know that you look at and you say, I think there's one for one that it just the one you just sent me for Green Mountain Economic.
Yeah, and then part of that is there's dues that you pay as a town, and you have to look and see what your statutory requirement is to support some of these. Like Two Rivers, obviously, we send the money per capita. Green Mountain Economic Development Corp. There's something per capita that you send. So there's, you know, for the most part, those are something you're paying almost like a dues. I think more of it as a dues than appropriation. So if the food shelf wants to go, I think they should go through social.
Well, historically, they've never applied. The churches have always supported the food shelf. That was their source of funding.
Yep.
The four churches that established the food shelf.
You know, you have these three that may or may not continue or not. You know, there's opportunities to grant money to other entities too.
Well, just looking at, you know, I don't know if this number is right, but it looks like they're asking for like a $1,200 appropriation, which I imagine for Quintown would be a sizable chunk of money. It doesn't seem like that's the correct number, but to say, okay, we're not going to support a particular entity may impact their budgeting also.
Right.
So it's another consideration.
Well, it's like the gentleman that came in 2 years ago for the Stagecoach, you know, kind of gave us how the formula is set up. You know, I think 10% of the funding comes from the town, maybe. You know, just showed how we tied into their budget. Do we want?
Good intention of a good work
It came up as a topic, you know, something to talk about.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's good information to have, because, you know, like we were talking about, you know, there was years ago where there were some appropriations where we didn't even know who the identity was. Was it appropriate sum of money? It was a period of time we didn't even ask for money. We just kind of said, this is what we'll give you, type of, you know. And then we found out, like, in Stagecoach, they're like, you know, you really should be here and only give us this much money, you know. And you have whatever. What do you bring in? You know, we had, you know, double the ridership of the next town, you know, that was even more fun.
Okay, so,
yeah.
So can we just hit the highlights of this draft budget? Because there's obviously some
And I was thinking, you know, Lindley not here. I mean,
and this is just
probably look at that a little harder next time, but.
Absolutely. This is the first draft. Obviously, we reached out to Kirk White at the state to figure out what the retirement's going to be. You know, in this last budget year, we went from 13.84% to 19.5%. So I'm looking at like 22%. I'm not really sure, waiting to see I know that Kirk is reaching out to Beth Pierce to talk to her a little bit to see, because you don't know what our portion of retirement is going to be. We don't have a say in that. It comes directly from the state. I know there was a comment from Kirk about us going to, his suggestion was that we went from Vermont State Employee Retirement, so VSERS, to VMERS, Vermont Retirement, Vermont Municipal Retirement, and I which was what I was familiar with. And but when I spoke to the state, she was like, you can't, once you're in VSERS, you can't go to VMERS. Kirk did say he'd be willing to, if we were interested in that, that he could, he would be happy to, support that legislation, but obviously that's not going to help us for this budget year. So very small health insurance increase. Actually, the premium only went up 0.10%. So I did look at this in the past. I think that we budgeted 12% for a premium increase. So I actually cut this to 10. You can see that I have a couple notes. There's still some things that I need to double check, like my FEMA schedule for our ERAF. I need to check some debt schedules. I wasn't in the office when I was working on this. But if you skip along, you're going to get to the constable.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see my note, Constable Matt, below. So basically, I took a full-time constable, saying 20, at this rate, 40 hours a week, 100 hours of OT, part-time person, and at 10 hours a week, and because that's something that you can talk about, so you can see what that cost is. And obviously, at that point, you have to pick up retirement, workers' comp increases, so there's some other stuff, so I did try to look at that. Increased gas, increased, trying to take a first rough draft at it. Staff, if that's what you asked for, that's what I had done.
I looked at some numbers on that too, if I understand correctly. Roughly, the benefits and withholding and all of that winds up being about the same as the person's salary.
Well, it depends. I think I looked at this. Let me see what I put in here. What I'm missing here is, this is why I'm talking about this out loud, the health insurance.
Right.
So I would have to add a health insurance premium in here.
Right.
So,
and I calculated that as...
Depends if they need a family plan single, right?
Anyway, I calculated that as 2,100 or 21. It's the same as a fourth of what you had for the town office. So anyway, what I wound up with was about $100,000 for a full-time, for all expenses.
Yeah, because easily, I'm looking right here at 63 plus the social,
and
plus 11.7 for retirement, workers'
which comes up
five.
To about 80.
Yeah.
So,
attack, yeah. Oh,
so the difference is $20,000, which... Now that does not include the part-time. That's all one full-time. But it seems to me that's sounds like a pretty good investment.
Oh.
If my numbers are at all accurate.
Yeah. So once I'll add the health insurance line, but yeah, my numbers are accurate with what I have here, so you're not far off. When we looked at this before with the state police, we looked at this 2 years ago, and I think we were looking at 40 to 43,000, and that was only going to get us maybe 20 hours a week, because their rate was quite high. So
the 48 or the $24 an hour, you're up to 48, 49,000.
Yeah. So you're right. I mean, this
roughly
is what.
Twice,
yeah. I was just looking for a speed car.
But in terms of value, that may be a good event.
What is the value of a full-time police officer in the town of Bethel?
Well, you get four times as much time as you do.
Really?
I think the challenge.
What's the value of a full-time police officer in the town of Bethel?
I think the challenge that we're having right now, Carl, is, like we had said,
I know you're getting back into it financially, I get it.
Is finding somebody, you look at any place like road construction, we deal with quite a bit.
So you're all fighting for the same pool, and we're only looking to hire somebody for 20 hours of part-time, or you get what you pay for, right? You get somebody that comes in, they can only give you hours on Sunday, maybe at night or something, you know?
What Laura was saying before, and the other people from River Street were suggesting, is you might be able to invest in our community in things like infrastructure, sidewalks, entryways into the community, things like that that will last through the community so that you can address some of the speed vehicle issues in particular, and not have to feel like you're being backed into a full-time police force for the town of Bethel, because once you get started, it's just like tarring a road. Once you start tarring roads, you got to keep tarring them. And, you know, it sounds like sort of like the argument that I get because we have two milk cows and everybody thinks we should have 50. Because you can amortize the expense, and it doesn't make sense. And that we would be creating a law enforcement society, a law enforcement environment in this community that may not be long-term beneficial. And we aren't looking at some of the other issues that could ameliorate the particularly the speed and traffic issues that could be addressed in long-term community social development as opposed to law enforcement.
Well, again, you know,
I'd like to just add on what Pearl was saying. Is in the last Selectboard meeting, you know, there was a lot of conversation about issues beyond just eating, like substance misuse and, you know, issues about dogs. And I think those things, you know, right on the heels of the human services conversation, have historically been dealt with much more effectively through non-police approaches. So I think, you know, these things tie really well together and the conversation goes well together. And I do think it's really worthwhile to consider that level of investment into the existing services and the organizations that have served our communities so well, and you know, consider investing in them rather than more policing.
Well, I think
we had a call for more. That's
I know, you know, there's four of you here tonight, but we've heard on the other end. People are saying we want to see someone out there write tickets. We want to see somebody.
I think there's some benefit to that. There's some things that you can't sign your way out of. Or
I don't think right now, Carl, to answer your question, that we are right here saying that we're going to have a full-time police force.
No, I think we're just throwing that out there. Somebody's presenting to me that you can't afford not to do this.
Yeah.
And all I'm saying is that once you create that environment of full-time law enforcement, you have a completely different aspect of the town. So that's all I was saying.
I appreciate deeply the comments from both of you about that. But I also want to say that was it Thursday night? We had a knock on our back door. The Wednesday night, that fella had driven off of the road on North Main and gone into the wasn't a river, but
it's the backwater area.
The backwater area. We wound up with the highway patrol, two ambulances, and the fire department trying to find his car, take care of him, and we were deeply appreciative of all that. But now, my guess is because of the condition that the fellow was in, it's going to take another day or two of the constable time just to do the paperwork. So, I mean, that's another piece of the puzzle. And it is a puzzle.
And this is just, you know, as Carol knows from being on the board in the past, you know, first right of the budget is usually kind of not just what you need, but what you want, or, you know, your wish list and how does it fit. And then,
And over the next month and a half, we're going to say, get rid of this, or deduct that, or add this, and, you know, kind of move our way. And I think if we, you know, we talked about it a little bit, you know, it's kind of one of those things, if we did decide to maybe go in a full-time position, that we'd probably be something that we'd put on the warning, you know, vote on at the community level. But we have heard it on multiple levels. We've heard, you know, someone, you know, do we need any policing? We've had someone, you know, we need more policing, and then we have the, up until this past year, it was going pretty well, but we had a kind of a good thing going with a good constable that was, you know, could do the full, the half-time thing. And now we don't have that, so now it's kind of, now the speeders are back, and, you know.
We also don't have the bump out.
Yeah, which will go back in the spring.
Yeah, we got to get
so
rid of both.
We have one more year, so they're going back in the spring.
Did we have them all summer?
No.
We didn't put them in this year because we were still doing, well, we were still doing construction, obviously, on Main Street. But
you just can't get rid of them all.
Yeah, there's other options, too. There's more information that's going to come out in the Better Connections grant.
Also have to look at what the town wanted for police services when the town decided that they wanted to have a constable. What were they looking for? And it was traffic control and dealing with dogs and those types of things. It was not, you know, I don't think the drug
culture.
I don't think the drug culture was as strong back then when you're talking about going back several years. But we might have to put it on the warrant and ask the town, you know, now what are your priorities?
But it's tricky because, you know, Bethel has always kind of taken advantage of other sources of policing in around the town that doesn't directly affect us financially. So like the state police, the Windsor County sheriffs, and what's happening is they're all shorthanded now. So you don't see them in town doing some of that, you know, speed enforcement that you used to see, because we used to take advantage of that, you know, right? And you don't see nearly as much of that anymore.
And it was probably 20 minutes after the local folk were at our house
before the state highway patrol got there.
So we will move on. So there's other things in here, so we talked about that. That was just something that I put in here. I have to take another look at the revenues, because which I hadn't thought of until just now was, this will happen when you're doing it by yourself. Right? You can get up, start talking about it. Oh yeah, I didn't increase the ticket revenue. But then parks and public places, we're obviously looking at, we've been talking about doing flower baskets, etc., doing a little bit more there. So some of this was a reduction. We put some money in the budget to work on the stone wall, which obviously I haven't found anybody yet, so I think we'll end up maybe trying to move some of that into a capital fund and holding it and putting half the amount. Like we did 10,000 last year, we do 5,000 this year, we might actually be able to get some. Yeah. And so that's what I was thinking there. There obviously you'll see my notes where I'll say double check this or what's Highland leasing. Reducing the town hall, I've done the same thing through the fire department, the town hall budgets. We all have building repair lines in there. So, but what makes more sense is to do put some amount of money in there, $1,500-$1,600 to deal with the stuff that comes up. But the bigger things that need to be done for town hall, for the fire department, the town office, all that needs to go into the capital building fund, and we have a schedule for that. So we need to take care of that. Thanks, Carl. The other thing we talked about under town officials was adding a stipend for the fire warden and the tree warden. So you can see that I had added those in this iteration of the budget. It made a note in here under government operations. You had asked, you said about putting some money in for social media, basically hosting, maybe paying to host the like any website, like Equity Inclusion Committee has a website, and obviously the town does, but so we had looked at that. I had put in, we put in Red Cross shelter maintenance. Obviously, I had my note about questionnaire about replacing the storage unit. We're not replacing that sucker for $1,200, but the listeners had given me their budget. government operations, capital improvement, or no, the reappraisal fund, the listeners are saying that in the research they've done, they think we have what we need for the capital fund right now for the reappraisal, so that's why I dropped this amount down. So they're in the middle of looking at reading other RFPs, and it's definitely something that we're gonna be looking at, probably doing a rolling reappraisal, which would be over most likely 2 years, sometimes three, depending. But we need to definitely get that nailed down this winter, because we need to get into somebody's schedule. Because the people that do townwide reappraisals are fewer and farther between. So, let's see. So, we have a couple notes here. Like I said, check debt schedule. Obviously, we budgeted money for the town garage last year for a debt, which we didn't go through. So, I basically said, all right, let's not put it in for a loan payment, let's add it to the capital building fund so that we can kind of reserve, set some money aside, because obviously we're going to need to bring in an engineer or something up there to look at the site and decide what we're gonna do. So yeah, this is the first iteration. I need to talk to the town clerk about town clerk fees. She usually pays twice a year. I'm not sure where she's at right now. So this is just the first step.
So a couple of questions that I had, not like getting into the weeds. So
yeah, much. Sure.
So for the next meeting, can we just, more like the highway rehab, highway equipment trust fund,
yep,
and the capital improvement fund, can we just get some up-to-date,
sure,
schedules of showing, yep, you know, how those investments fit into the long-term picture of our, sure, improvement funds?
Yeah. And
just
so
I can, is that right? Be higher, lower,
right,
you know,
yep,
as we're going through here.
Yep. I went through and looked at
it. I had to chuckle that we're getting, you know, it seems like up and up and up on the repairs and tires and parts for the,
I know,
the,
and
I'm a little concerned about that one.
Well, I have not had a conversation with Alan about that. I threw a number in there, and I increased it because if you looked at the history, this is what we're doing. So, I know. So.
And the Lister,
their budget came directly
being
from,
being that
the
they are fully staffed, we need, can we take out the assessor services now?
Well, he'd asked, Mo and Judy asked that we did not, that we leave it in there because they're not sure about the third person. Obviously,
well, I mean,
not sure.
If we're gonna pay $25,500 worth of,
right,
wages, I think we could take the assessor services.
Well, the problem is this, is right now we're looking at, you have all, you know, Louise is getting closer and closer every day to retirement, right? So, which we thought she would have by now. So Mo and Judy are both new listers. So their issue is they're struggling a bit with commercial property, which makes sense. I've seen other towns where they bring somebody in to help them appraise commercial property because that's what they're trained in. They were given some names by Rick Benson of people that are certified to look at commercial property. The other thing is, too, they're not sure, say Louise does end up retiring, are they going to want to bring in an assessor, too? They've also said themselves, in regards to how old they are, they've said, you know, at some point we're going to want to retire, and so the idea of bringing in an assessor is still one that they want to keep on the table. But so I specifically had a conversation with them. This was their numbers that they brought in, and obviously we haven't used the assessor, but I could see us using some of it for commercial properties, which I think would be fair to have somebody come in and appraise commercial properties that has certification to do so.
And,
no.
and maybe just overall in the municipal office piece, we had the 15 hours a week position.
Yep, that's, I
and then it just seemed like all the, I'll call it supplies, but it's like postage and computers and all that. It seems
crazy.
Like everything is like, mm-hmm, considerably more.
Well,
as you go down through all those line items, it's like, you know, something that might have been 500 last year, 1800 this year, or, you know.
Right.
Seems like everything's up. So just,
well,
I just don't,
it is. So we went through it.
Take a little harder look at that. Or,
well, because what we used to do is we bought envelopes and things
like telephone,
postage,
like, you
and,
know, 5,100 to 8,600. You know,
well, because
so,
we need to upgrade. We don't have high-speed internet, really, at the town office. We get a free account from Comcast. And now that we moved from a software system that's cloud-based, it's slower than death. So we have so easy fiber. We're not paying for our current Comcast connection to the internet. We get that for free from Comcast. You get one free account.
You get something free from Comcast?
Believe it or not.
I don't.
Well, we do. And that's
that in the record.
But they won't even let you to upgrade it. It's very expensive. So we're having EC Fiber, which was much cheaper, because we did try to work out a deal with Comcast. So you're right. The other thing, too, is, you know, we're right. It is a little bit. And supplies seem to be keep growing. I think some of that maybe it was during COVID when some of the stuff maybe needed to go to one department and it got coded to another. I can go back and look at some detail, but I'm also looking for someone to do some grant writing and other things, you know. So that was one of the reasons that I had put that number in there, just a shot in the dark to look at. But I can also see where I put in telephone. I said double check the EC Fiber bill. But you're right, everything goes up, you're right. And some of this was just me throwing in a little bit of a higher number because I'm looking at two-year histories to see what it spent. So I'm trying to be reasonable about what we're actually spending versus budgeting, because I can budget $500, but if we always spend $1,500, we're just fooling ourselves.
So we'll just, you know, pick it apart a little more.
We absolutely should. And you guys had wanted fire warden, tree warden, we added those. I think Paul was going to update us a little bit on the storage unit. And so overall, obviously, it's a 5%. This is our first thing. I know my debt schedules. I didn't have debt schedules with me when I was doing the budget. So I know there's some savings there. And we'll go back through and look at it. I need Alan to look at his.
We ended up being flat last year.
Pretty close, yeah. I'm not sure. I've seen the 411 for the listers, so we can see if there's any growth in the grand list. But we also have a pending possible charitable pious contribution that we need to look into a little bit more. I was out last week, so or part of the week, so we'll look into that. I think we're going to have a town attorney take a peek at that. There's some very specific rules about someone getting a charitable or pious contribution. But anyway, so yeah, like I said, this is the first step, I think you're right, we should put it in at the next meeting, go through it in a little more detail. I can refine it a little bit in the next 2 weeks and look at those debt schedules and look at some things and get Alan to look at it. And I passed the road budget off to Ryan Slack to ask Ryan to take a peek, and I haven't heard back from him either, so. In all honesty, I was doing this at home over my vacation.
I know that wages for either rec or parks, the lifeguards, wherever that comes in, both of those wage files are reduced.
Yep, that was a conversation I had with Dietrich about what we have for staffing last year, and we're looking, first of all, it's very hard to find lifeguards.
What we're looking at was
paying existing lifeguards a little bit more, but cutting some positions. And by adjusting hours of the pool and different things. So her and I had gone through that, and she's going to create a schedule over the winter of kind of about a dollar value. So you start with this base salary, but as you have certifications, there's a little bit more money that goes with it. So that was surge. We had a whole conversation about it. So
I just want to make sure that we're budgeting sufficient.
Yeah, no, we went through it to talk about that too, because that was my concern, especially too. Hard to find people.
Right.
Harder and harder to find people.
Paul? Want to go through the emergency shelter?
Oh, yeah.
And came away with the opinion that it needed to be replaced,
that it was beyond, you know, repair. So I made some calls, there's some pictures there of the existing container, the way it is. Yes, it is covered with surface rust inside. The doors has surface rust and some rot down at the bottom. Cindy seemed to think there was evidence of rodents in there, but I didn't find any of that. And I just put out traps last week, and as of today, there's nothing in the traps. The areas that are looking very bad in the corners, I hit them with hammers. They're solid. It's surface rust. It's not, it hasn't blown through or anything. So what you got here, I made some phone calls through PacVan and another company out of Essex. So you're looking at $5,200 for a new one, plus the delivery. I also talked with two different scrap haulers that said there was a possibility they could remove it, but we would get nothing out of it. It was by the time and time and effort and whatnot, they would end up keeping what we got for it for scrap. Talked to Jen at the transfer station. She said she'd love to have it down there for storage, but we'd have to get it. We'd have to pay somebody to come in and take it out and whatnot. And then down at the bottom here, I've got a hold of carriage sheds just to see what they might have in a similar size that Cindy is suggesting, an 8x10 or an 8x12. So, you know, those are the costs that you've got. My suggestion is that we go in and work on the rust spots that are in there and paint the interior of it. I don't see any daylight showing anywhere. And do a little bit of work on the doors. I lubricated all the hinges and all the latches so the doors operate very well. You can get in and out of. And just go with it the way it is for now until we can make another plan.
Now, there was some discussion, I thought, last time that there was water in there.
No.
So there's no evidence of any water.
No evidence of water in there.
Okay.
No.
That was just chatting. Teresa, I wonder if there's any potential grant money out there or state funds to, you know, to do anything with an emergency relief shelter, you know, supplies, if there's anything that going out there. But, maybe, like you were saying, in the short term, doing some of those short-term fixes, but we only have a long-term solution.
What, $1,200 or so in the budget, and we need to go in and sand off the worst spots and go in and spray the whole thing and get more life out of it. I went up on top on the roof of it. It's not broken through at all. It's, you know, solid up there. The floor is solid. But there's, you know, there's a lot of surface rust on it.
But so it's definitely something that's going to last more than a year. This looks like with some maintenance, this could be give you a few more years.
But we can make it weatherproof and roadproof, you think?
Yeah. Well, there's a couple of gaps on one of the front doors that potentially something could get in, but I don't see any sign of it in there. Looks like there may have been something that got trapped in there. There's a pile of fur over one point. So, no, I think with a little work, it can last a bit longer.
Now, the other piece of that, talked about the potential of taking inventory of the items that we have in there. Remember we talked about potentially, you know, not having enough certain materials that we have to purchase, you know, somewhere. Is that something that she's been working on?
Cindy's done all
that.
Because that may be, you know, we can't get money from the state to help fund that.
There's also money in the there's money in the that capital fund. It was like $725, I think, in that. And then there was a talk. I think actually that was something that Cindy had mentioned was maybe them getting a bigger annual appropriation, so that, you know, I think currently what I put in there now is money because we have the generator maintained. We have a contract with the AP generator, so they come in and deal with that. And I think that I had, I guess it's still just this $1,200, and but there's still money left because I think that I paid the, I feel like Yankee Generator was about $725, mm-hmm. so there may be money in the budget. I'll double check that. Because we may have money already built in the budget for if we Yankee Generator that annual contract is whatever, $700, then we already have money built in here, so we could be buying supplies a little each year, so it may not be an increase in the budget.
Okay. That's good.
But yeah, thank you so much.
I think we can get more, we can get a couple of years out of it in a few more years. Because the prices are just out of sight.
Yeah,
that's pretty good. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, yeah. And not necessarily the size that we want either, you know.
Right.
Right.
We're going to get something much larger than necessarily need.
Well, right, you know, also right now there's material limited, but there was also, somebody was telling me 100 blankets that we've got that is being stored at Carmel School because they were concerned about putting them in there. And if you put them in plastic totes and put them in there, it's going to fill up a good part of that.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Thank you so much.
Can I increase anything left on the town manager before you get 30 seconds?
I got nothing.
All right. We just have the meeting minutes from the 25th. Amendments to it, are we good to approve them as noted?
Thanks, Laura.
Thank you. I didn't know if Rick, Eric,
yep.
Derek, whether you want to be written in as Derek or as Rick. Is it maybe Derek?
My legal name's Derek, I'm fine with that. Most people know me as Rick.
Okay.
I go back from Alan Pat. He always calls me Derek. I call you Rick, and then he's looking at me like I'm talking about the same.
So in the emergency storage replacement section, page 2, I offered to spearhead investigating the problem, not solving the problem.
Come on!
So if we don't approve that, then you're still
investigating.
Solving,
right? Okay. Investigating. Well, yes, I suppose technically you could do that.
I think it's the way it is.
I got $5,200 in my pocket.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, there we go. All
right. Seeing a motion to approve the meeting minutes as amended.
So moved. Second.
Anyone in favor?
Aye.
And there were some other meeting minutes in your packet. And was there anything else that could come before the board this evening? Yeah,
right? There's a light bulb.
Uh-oh.
That's from the list.
Thank you.
calculating.
I know, and I know we've had a conversation about that, so I'll, I'm gonna scan on tomorrow, so I'll ask him about that. What the status is for that, because we had a conversation about that, that month ago maybe, so we didn't talk about it. Well, that's the
point. Had a bunch of trees, all the trees, but.
Yeah.
So we didn't get a good idea.
It could be that he talked to somebody else, and he didn't want to cut it, so maybe he talked to somebody and he waited for, I know he had, I think he had a couple that maybe 40 acre, and he was waiting for him to come do them, so I'm gonna ask.
Oh, maybe that's. It's a good environment, it's looking along, you know.
Yeah, there you go. Well, thank you. I'll ask him about it tomorrow.
It's on Dave's side.
Yeah, so he said Dave's on this one. I got it.
Maybe we can go over there that time.
Yeah.
I already talked about that.
Mark?
You were in the crossroads.